A very good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee. We've received apologies this morning from Pauline McNeill and Colette Stevenson. And our first item of business is an evidence session on the justice provisions in the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Bill. And I refer members to papers one and two. And I'm very pleased to welcome to today's meeting our first panel of witnesses, Mr. Kenny Donnelly, Procurator Fiscal Policy and Engagement of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, and Mr. David Fraser, Executive Director of Court Operations at the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service. Nice to see you both. And we appreciate the time that you're taking to join us this morning. So we'll now just move directly to questions. We have up to about an hour and 15 minutes or so. So I wonder if I can maybe just start things off by asking you a sort of general question about the provisions of the bill. In obviously your written submissions that have both been sent in to the committee, they've been very helpful in our understanding of the perspectives of both your respective organisations in terms of the provisions of the bill, but also in terms of next steps and opportunities to make some of the sort of COVID provisions permanent. So it might just be helpful before we go into questions from members to ask maybe for a general update on how the courts and casework in the case of Crown Office is beginning to adapt now that restrictions are easing and that we're hopefully beginning to return to our new normal. And I'll maybe come to you first, David, and then bring in Kenny after that.
Okay, thank you very much. Good morning. We are still very much on track, I would say, from when I last was before the committee, that we've got a high degree of confidence that by 2026 we should be out of the woods in terms of backlogs. The reduction in social distancing has certainly helped. Within the court environment, we still have 1 metre of social distancing. We were looking to decommission some of our jury sites, our remote jury sites, but that will very much depend on when we actually move to zero physical distancing and get jurors back into the courts without face masks. That doesn't include all of them because we still need some in terms of the recovery programme. In order to deal with the backlogs. So I think we are on track. We're not out of the woods yet. And I think that some of the provisions that are within the legislation, I would see as we absolutely need to continue.
Yeah. Thanks very much. And I'll bring in Kenny now.
It's a similar picture. So obviously the pandemic has set the criminal justice system back, as it has most things in life. The caseload has backed up. Everything and every stage in the process has slowed down. So at one stage it stopped altogether, and then as it's picked back up, it's slowed down. And the result of that is that at each stage in the process, there's a build-up of work that needs to come through the system.
Yeah.
So we're having to look at each of the stages in the process, from the initial receipt of cases and getting them marked when they first appear in court, preparing them for service of complaint and indictment, and thereafter, once they're in the court, get them through the court. The problem for us in doing that and trying to alleviate the pressure and to increase the throughput of work is that the volume of business has increased so markedly, and all of that business still requires to be worked on, still requires to be managed, still requires work to be done, updating victims, making sure that the cases are in a fit state, etc. That the sheer volume of work is actually delaying our ability to address the backlogs, and so it's a long project to clear, not just at the court end, but to clear the entire pipe of the backlog of work that's built up.
Thanks very much. And just picking up on the point that you made, David, in relation to you're still obviously complying with 1 metre physical distancing, have you got an idea of when you may be able to remove that? That seems to be quite a sort of stepping stone back towards being able to function at more or less normal capacity.
We are and have been throughout the pandemic very much guided by the Scottish Government in terms of the guidance. So, I mean, we review consistently in terms of all the new guidance that comes out. So when we get to the position, I think, where the removal of face masks, I think, will be key. And there is zero social distancing, that becomes the trigger point for us in terms of actually reopening, getting people back into the buildings, jurors, and almost what the new norm is going to look like post-pandemic.
Yeah. Don't know if you want to come in on that at all, Kenny.
It would certainly help. Obviously, I think we mentioned in our written submission that the remote jury centres model was innovative. It was a fantastic opportunity for us to at least make some progress with disposal of the solemn casework. But it does slow things down a little. So there's a day at the start of each of those trials where nothing is done other than the remote empanelment of the jury. So the trial doesn't really start until everyone turns up on day two. So whilst we've made some good progress in getting through some of the business through that model, removing that requirement of that day would allow us to hopefully increase the output of cases at the court end of the business.
Thanks very much. That's helpful. I mean, these practical issues are probably sometimes points that we can miss a little bit in terms of the kind of input and evidence that we're taking. So it's helpful to understand that. I wondered if I can ask a follow-up question, and again, probably David, it's one for you. And in the letter that we received just this week from yourselves, which was very helpful in terms of the virtual summary cause trials, I note that in the letter you expressed a sort of intention or a desire going forward to establish domestic abuse courts in hopefully each sheriffdom in Scotland. But I think in the previous submission that you'd sent in, you argue that the use of virtual hearings is perhaps one that should be dealt with by individual courts. So, for example, I would imagine things like consideration of rural issues, city-based courts and so on would feed into that. So I'm just really wondering if you can maybe expand a little bit on some of the decision-making or the rationale behind how each sheriffdom might put court, virtual court arrangements in place.
Certainly. I mean, the advantage I see in the project group led by Sheriff Principal Powell issued the report in January, which I'm sure you'll be aware of. The advantage as I see in moving forward in GH&I is you create the single court. You have an element of specialism that starts to be developed. It is under the leadership of the Sheriff Principal, and as that model is established, and there is still a little bit of work in terms of actually how that will practically be developed and implemented, but once established in GH&I, then it would be up to the other Sheriff Principals then to look at what their individual needs within their sheriffdom are based on the model that's developed. So there may be a little bit of variances between, but the key essence and the principles of what we're trying to do would remain, in as much as the vulnerable witnesses would be supported at a site external to the court environment, which I think is important given the other areas of work where it's actually proven that it can be quite traumatic to enter a court environment.
Thanks very much. Do you want to come in at all, Kenny?
No, I would agree with what David said there. I think it's another option which allows us to better manage the work. The specialism point is a good one. Separately, it's another opportunity for victims to give their evidence in these cases without necessarily being in the same building as their accuser. And again, I think that's to be welcomed where that's what the victim wants. And so it's another opportunity for us to do things in a different way, which may allow some business to proceed in a way that's safer for the victim and actually expedites the disposal of the case. So I'm very much in favour of that.
Indeed. Thanks for that. Just a final quick question before I hand over to Russell. Just to clarify a point, back in January 2022, two, so just a couple of months ago, we received an update that the backlog would probably last till about 2025. I think Eric McQueen updated on that. But I think, and I know recently, and perhaps in some of the evidence that's been submitted, there's been reference to it being 2026. I just wondered if you can clarify that.
Yes, I'm painfully aware of that. I think when Mr. McQueen was here, that was our projections based at that time. When I last appeared before you, I gave the most recent and up-to-date information I had. And as I say, I mean, it is 2026 that I anticipate, potentially. It does depend in terms of what comes our way. But I think, you know, it's quite safe to say that's a realistic estimate in terms of...
Okay. Thanks very much for that. That's helpful clarification. Okay, I'm just going to hand straight on to Russell Finlay. We've got a number of members are interested just in sticking with the issue around court business by electronic means. So I'll bring in Russell, and then I'll bring in Rona Mackay after that.
Thank you very much. I was going to ask specifically about the issue of fiscal fines. The legislation allowed these to be go from £300 limit to £500 limit. Could you maybe just tell me what kind of offences would have therefore been brought into that upper limit?
I'm sorry, I don't have the detail of the specific offence types, but what we sought to do in analysing the increase from £300 to £500 was looking at sentencing in the Justice of the Peace Court in that range, and looked at the offence types. I can get some information for you on the specific offences. It would need me to go through the changes in guidance that's come through on a number of different fronts. So I can give you an idea of that. But the majority of the business in the Justice of Peace Court is road traffic, and so we couldn't do it for that because it's a reserve matter and we're within the scheme which requires to be operated there because of the endorsation and disqualification aspects of it. So it will be the other routine matters that go to the Justice of the Peace Court, disorder, violence, low-end violence, vandalism and such likes. But I don't have the detail of that. I don't want to speculate. I can get details of the crime types for you, if that would help.
Sure, thank you. Now, the Deputy First Minister previously told Parliament that rejection of a fiscal fine was treated as a request by the alleged offender to be prosecuted for the offence. Yet, in July last year, data was released via FOI showing that 30% of those who rejected fiscal fines faced no further action. Is it the case this has become a bit of a safe bet for criminals or offenders and a bit of a slap in the face for victims?
I'm not particularly aware of the FOI request. I would need to make some inquiry about that. That sounds too high. My understanding is that when fiscal fines are rejected, the normal course would be for them to be prosecuted. My understanding is it's very, very small numbers that are discontinued, but I'd like to take that away and look at it, and I'll certainly communicate to the committee what the up-to-date figures are.
Yeah, this data was over 2 or 3 years, and it was showed quite a steady 30% level, whereby stuff was not then prosecuted.
I appreciate that. I'll need to have a look at it. It's not something that I'd anticipated this morning coming up, so sure. I've not looked into that, but I will certainly look at it and come back to you.
Also, in respect to fiscal fines, these cases would, in many cases of this nature, would have ordinarily been in a Justice of Peace Court, would have been therefore public. Do the public have any means of seeing what's happening with these particular cases?
No, not really. These are alternatives to prosecution. They're a device which are used to make the court more efficient. It's allowing those who don't dispute their cases to accept their responsibility at the earliest possible stage and have the matter disposed of. But it's done on a private correspondence basis. It's not done in a public forum. So as far as I'm aware, there's no public information that I could provide to individuals that's what we've done. We would ordinarily advise the public that the case has been dealt with by way of an alternative to prosecution rather than the specific detail of it.
Given some of these cases can involve violence and involve fines of up to £500, it's a significant level of offending. Is there not a slight risk about open justice not being adhered to?
Well, it's a tool which the Parliament's provided to us, and I think a tool that we properly use to make the court more efficient. The Lord Advocate lays down prosecution policy as to what the framework should be within which these fines should be issued. And it's then down to individual judgment and professional judgment of prosecutors as to where and when it's appropriate to issue the fine. Whilst the increase from £300 to £500 does make it significant, you know, a greater penalty than would otherwise be the case. The number of cases that are impacted in that range is relatively small. I think it was 4% of JP court disposals were within that range. The fiscal fines have been issued are within 3% of the disposals within that range. So we're matching pretty much the disposals which the court would be granting, albeit in a different way from doing it in open court.
And the final question on that is, if the public have no means of finding out what has happened with the disposal, are victims told?
So again, my understanding is that we would tell a victim that the case has been dealt with by an alternative to prosecution. So the alternative to prosecution can be a number of things, but we wouldn't go into the detail of what the alternative to prosecution was.
I'm sorry, I did say a last question, but this is the last question. But presumably then, if a victim was told that, they might assume or be led to believe that means a fiscal fine. Well, they wouldn't necessarily know if it's rejected and then no further action is taken. That level of detail wouldn't be explained.
So if a victim asked us if a case had been, the disposal of a case had been no further action, they would be told there was no further action taken, not that it had been disposed of by an alternative. They may not assume, or they may assume that it's a fiscal fine, but alternative to prosecution covers a range of options that are available to the prosecutor. So as well as fiscal fine, there are warnings, there are fiscal work orders and such like. So there are other options. Diversion from prosecution is another option which would be coined an alternative to prosecution. So there's a broad church of options available to the professional judgment of the prosecutor, which would cover, it would be covered in a range of alternatives.
Yep. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay, I think we'll maybe just, I'll hand over to Rona. I was anticipating some questioning around court business by electronic means, but so I'll just bring you in at this point, and then I will bring in Fulton McGregor after that.
Thanks. Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Yes, a couple of questions. I know some of my colleagues have further questions on the virtual trials, but Mr. Fraser, just if I could come to you, thank you for your letter, your helpful letter. There's just a few questions I have arising from that, and it's where you say at the start of January this year, a further 10, it's about the, sorry, I beg your pardon, it's the Aberdeen domestic abuse pilots. So at the start of January 2022, a further 10 cases were scheduled for trial, of which two have proceeded, one was deserted, and three were converted to a physical trial. So I'm just wondering what the reasons would be for converting them to a physical trial.
That's one of the frustrations that I have. They can be converted to a physical trial for any reason at all. They don't even have to give advise the court of what that reason is.
And sorry, who takes that decision?
The sheriff will take the decision, but there is no compulsory at the moment for us to use virtual trials at all. It is by the consent of all parties. So if an individual chooses not to take part in it, then that is a good enough reason for it to be converted or not to go ahead. Notwithstanding, initially, there will have been a process that will have gone through to say, yes, this case is suitable for virtual trial, yes. It will be set down in terms of that, but for some reason during the course of the process, someone may have changed their mind, and that's a good enough reason for it not to proceed, and it then goes back into the physical trials.
Okay. And just, I mean, my arithmetic's not great, but I'm just, of the further 10 cases, two proceeded, one was deserted, and then three converted to physical trial. That leaves, like, four left. What would happen to them?
I will need to come back to you on that one. They will still be in the pipeline, I think.
You know, just a general thing about how that works. I mean, was that... did that trial go according to plan, as it were? Would you say it was successful?
The virtual trials that we've run, and we ran an initial pilot way back in 2020, and back in that time, you'll be aware there were no trials running at all. So this was seen as a vehicle in order to get us at least getting trials running.
Mm-hmm.
We ran the two in Inverness, we ran a further in Aberdeen. Mm-hmm. There was a further, there was nine in total in terms of that tranche that mm-hmm. went ahead. The feedback we got was very positive
mm-hmm.
From sheriffs, defence, and those actually taking part.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of it achieved what we set out to achieve. We proved the concept. We then moved in, and I think, as I said, last year, Shared Principal Pile then focused it on domestic abuse cases.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, it is from my position that it's viable. It is an alternative. It gives us flexibility. There's a lot of advantages come with it. Mm-hmm. On your point of the four cases, I don't have that before me, but I'm quite happy to provide that if it would be helpful.
That would be useful. Thank you. And just one further question on that for me, as say, I know others have questions. With regard to vulnerable witnesses, and if you could maybe explain, and I'm not sure, Mr. Donnelly, if it's yourself or Mr. Fraser that would do this, in relation to the remote attendance by vulnerable witnesses in criminal cases, how does it compare to what was happening before the pandemic? We've heard from victim support and from Women's Aid that witnesses can find it a lot less intimidating, and they're very much in favour of it because it means there's no face-to-face contact often with alleged perpetrators. So I just wonder if I could have your thoughts on how the process has changed for vulnerable witnesses.
I'm quite happy to... Sticking with what we did in Aberdeen, I mean, we worked very closely with victim support to identify external sites so that we had the technological connections and they were supported at the remote sites. And it was very much welcomed in terms of removing them from the environment we've talked about already, where they potentially could see the accuser within the same building. Before that, I mean, we have a number of sites dotted across the country that are remote from courts where vulnerable witnesses have given evidence electronically for a number of years now.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, it was a concept which we then developed into the virtual trial model.
Mm-hmm.
And from what I've seen, it has been welcomed. Mr. Donnelly may want to add.
No, I totally agree with David's comments. There were a range of options available for vulnerable witnesses to give their evidence in different ways. They were always consulted about that and the appropriate measures explained and discussed. There were sometimes evidential challenges around some of that, but we would usually try and find a mechanism to allow the witness to give the evidence the best way for them. One of the range of options previously available was for the vulnerable witness to give their evidence by a remote link from CCTV. But as David says, the virtual model has tried to build on that to make it a much more mainstream and much more accessible and available option for victims.
Mm-hmm.
It's certainly my understanding from feedback from victims groups is that they're very much in favour of it.
Mm-hmm.
And anything which supports victims and allows them to engage in the process mm-hmm. and to give their evidence in the best mm-hmm. way possible for them and the least traumatic way for them is something that I think we have to explore as best we can and take forward.
So this is something you see continuing?
Absolutely. It's something that I think that beyond the legislation, something we should be looking at as a future way of delivering business for that kind type mm-hmm. and perhaps others.
Good. Thank you. Thanks.
Okay, thanks very much. Katie, I think, are you wanting to come in on this particular line of questioning?
If that's possible. I mean, the legislation that we're considering is suggesting that this would be a default. Now, from what you've said and from what we've been able to gather, it sounds like a very small number of cases have actually gone ahead up till now. So it's really difficult to take any view, given perhaps these might be the kind of cases that are most suitable for virtual cases if everybody's in agreement. So I suppose the issues that we're having to grapple with are why it would be a default where they could go ahead where there isn't the agreement of all parties, which is my understanding of how the legislation would work. So I presume it would be the sheriff at the end of the day that would decide whether it was appropriate for a case to be virtual. So that's quite a massive shift. If you like, the purpose of this legislation as it's been presented to us and the reason that we've been given as to why it's going through in a far more speedy process than would normally be the case in this Parliament is that this is to continue with practices which have been taking place during COVID. But the evidence that we're getting is that in reality, actually, virtual trials haven't been taking place in significant numbers. They haven't been the default. There's been a small number. So I suppose really what I'm asking is, what evidence have we got that this model that's been proposed in this legislation has actually been tested?
There's probably two dimensions. On the virtual summary trial model, it is most definitely my preference that you know we go down that route for domestic abuse cases as the default position. Of course, there will be exceptions where, for specific reasons, cases may have to be held physically. That's quite independent from virtual appearance generally, because what we have done since the pandemic is introduced the remote appearance of witnesses out with that type of cases. And at the moment in the High Court, we have professional witnesses, police officers and medical professionals that will give evidence remotely. And my understanding is we need that legislation for that to continue. And that dimension has significant benefits. Traditionally, we would have pulled consultants in, or colleagues would have asked them to attend.
Sorry, could I? I mean, I think sure. You're straying into other issues to do with evidence being given remotely. What we're considering in this legislation is the default position for all domestic abuse cases should be a virtual trial, even where parties do not agree. I appreciate it's your preference, and there may be reasons for that. What I'm saying to you is that we haven't really had that tested in many cases, have we?
We haven't, but the reason that it hasn't been tested and it hasn't taken over, and your comments earlier that was warmly welcomed by the third sector in support in terms of going forward with that, but there have not been the volume of cases because there's been no compulsor for these cases to be done virtually. It has only been where people have consented to it. And that's one of the fundamental reasons I would suggest that we haven't had the volumes that when we started this process, we anticipated we would have.
So wouldn't you think it would be more sensible to have a pilot with a significant tranche of cases being dealt with this in this way and then evaluate what the outcome of that would be rather than making this permanent shift to a default position of virtual, which is a significant change in the Scottish legal system?
I'm not sure it's quite so unusual as you may be thinking. I'm thinking of parallels with the Vulnerable Witnesses Act from 2019, which introduced the presumption for evidence by commissioner for certain categories of witness giving their evidence. So the default is, I think, a parallel or comparable to the presumption that legislation gave rise to. The presumption is rebuttable, as is the default. It would allow parties to make representations to the sheriff or to the judge that the default should be departed from, in the same way that there is a provision in the 2019 Act which allows parties where they think that the presumption in favour of evidence by commissioner is not the right way to give evidence to make representations to the court. And ultimately, the court's got that overriding interest in ensuring the fairness of the proceedings, the fairness of the trial, and will have the capacity to change the default or the presumption, depending on which piece of legislation we're looking at. At the moment, this is all available by application, and so the default position would streamline processes and allow the court to proceed on a particular basis, but with the ability for parties to challenge that and the authority of the court to change it. So I whilst I understand it's, mm-hmm. it's quite different, there are safeguards in place and there are parallels to be drawn with existing legislation.
With that, and it's, I look at it from the perspective of the benefits for the vulnerable witnesses and removing them from the court environment entirely, which I see as a phenomenal benefit. And as Mr. Donnelly says, I mean, there are parallels with what we've done in the past in terms of presumptions. And it doesn't mean that physical trials in domestic abuse would not continue. There would be specific reasons, I am sure, in a number of cases where it is better that they proceed on a physical basis. But by making the shift to the presumption that they would be virtual, it removes some of the barriers and the options to opt out for because the option is there, if you like, without actually coming to the court and having a detailed explanation of actually this is the specific reasons why it can't be, which we don't have at the moment.
Thank you. Before I hand over to Tolton McGregor, I'm just wanting to pick up on a point that you made in response to some of Rona's questions, David, if I may. You said that there had been a lot of positive feedback in relation to the Aberdeen virtual trials, but we've taken evidence from the Bar Association. In fact, that was just last week, and they spoke about their concerns about virtual trials as an option, because it, and I quote, diminished the solemnity of proceedings. So I'm just really wondering if you, I suppose, accept that not everybody is in favour of the virtual trial option, and if there is work ongoing to maybe kind of allay some of the fears around this option?
I absolutely accept. I mean, this is a big change in terms of how we run the organisation and those that interact with the organisation. And like all changes, you go on the change curve and different people are at different stages of that. We continue to work in terms of all the sort of digital innovations that we're doing with the Law Society. And in fact, the Law Society were a member of the virtual trial group that made the recommendations under Shared Principle Pile. So we do continue to work with all the different bar associations in North Strathclyde, and I'm deviating briefly, but let me make the point, is that we're engaging with them as well in terms of the virtual custody model as we roll that out as well. So we are very much involved with all of those that the changes affect, but I do accept that there are differing levels of excitement, shall I say, about the process we're going through.
Thanks very much. Okay, I'll now hand over to Fulton McGregor, and then I'll bring in Jamie Green after that.
Thanks a lot, Convener. My line of questioning just now anyway is actually following on quite well from Rona and Katie, so I do run the risk of repeating myself or asking yourselves to repeat yourself. I mean, I was involved in the Vulnerable Witnesses Bill, which has been mentioned, as were other members around the table. And I think at that point, and that was pre-pandemic, we didn't have any idea that COVID even existed. I think Scotland was very much on a route to, rightly or wrongly, I believe rightly, incidentally, for the record, but rightly or wrongly, we were on a route to making sure that vulnerable witnesses didn't need to go into a court set-up, given the trauma that could be experienced by them. And then the pandemic came, and I think as Katie Clark has kind of articulated, I think we all sort of felt that, you know, these would have been done more, and perhaps actually the stats are a wee bit surprising, if you like, given the opportunity that the pandemic, allowed for. All that said, I think what this legislation is asking is if we can allow some of that to continue in order to perhaps speed up the process of vulnerable witnesses being able to give their evidence out of court. So I guess my question is, do you feel that the legislation as drafted will allow you to do that, will allow you to make steps, started by the Vulnerable Witnesses Act and other processes that were already in place, and allow us to get to a situation where vulnerable witnesses in the most difficult of cases are not appearing at court? And I'm happy either or not.
Will I start?
Yeah.
Past it. From my perspective, yes. I mean, the legislation as it's currently drafted and the extensions are, from my perspective, essential for us to continue the work that we have started out on. And it does, as you quite rightly say, feed back to the general direction, which I think we are going as a justice system in supporting and making the environment as least traumatic as we possibly can for vulnerable witnesses and complainers. So I would very much support the continuation of what we currently have in place to allow us to continue the journey we're doing.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think that the journey is about providing support and opportunity for victims to give their evidence in the least traumatic way and in a way that makes them feel engaged in the process at the same time. And there are a number of vulnerable witnesses, pieces of legislation already that provide options and opportunities for that. And I think this is just another tool in the box to allow that evolution and that development of best practice to support vulnerable witnesses in their engagement with the criminal justice process. So that's why we're in favour of it at this stage. It's another opportunity to allow us to better support victims and giving their evidence in the best possible way.
So I guess the question from a legislation point of view, I'm hearing quite good levels of support from both of you, but do you feel that the legislation is required in order to, obviously there is other processes and you've both identified that, but the legislation is required to make this transition easier and give you more tools in order to get to that point?
Yeah. In a rhythm here.
I should be director.
No, not at all. Yes, from my perspective, I mean, we did have, under the previous legislation prior to this, the ability to have remote evidence given remotely, but that was on an application by application basis. What we do have is now that has been broadened to anyone potentially being able to give their evidence virtually, as opposed to the very narrow group of individuals that were able to do it. So in terms of what we currently have and what I hope will continue is the ability to go beyond that. And I did stray into earlier, it is not just in relation to the vulnerable witnesses, it's in relation to the professional witnesses as well. A number of police officers now and medical professionals are able to give their evidence from their own locations, which it means that they're not spending time commuting to the court, waiting in the court for potentially a trial to be adjourned to a further date. And it's valuable time out of their calendars, which they've got back in. And again, I mean, the feedback that we have on that dimension is very, very positive. And I think it's one we would want to keep on a permanent basis.
I think we've properly focused the debate this morning on vulnerable witnesses, but the legislation is required for more than that. It provides us opportunities for, as David has said, other witnesses to give their evidence remotely. So looking at it at the moment, we're piloting it in the High Court where all police and professional witnesses and expert witnesses can give their evidence remotely. So what that in practice means is that, for instance, a GP doesn't have to give up their practice if they live in a remote area and engage locums, which can be hard to get, expensive. They can make a slot in their diary when the court will accommodate them, giving their evidence remotely. It means police officers can be at the office doing other work rather than sitting in a court waiting room. Expert witnesses who are often far and wide across the world and present us with logistical and timing difficulties in terms of scheduling for trials can give their evidence from wherever they may be, subject to the control of the court. So the legislation will allow the court system to work more efficiently, as well as providing support to delivery of public service in other ways.
Thanks for that. I think it was really important to hear on the record some practical examples of how the legislation might impact in practice.
Okay, perfect, thank you. I'll just hand straight on to Jamie.
Thank you. First of all, if we work on the assumption that people are innocent until proven guilty as a cornerstone of the Scottish legal system, don't you think they deserve the right to physical trial if they want one?
Well, I don't think that any right is absolute. So they're entitled to ask for that. It's up to the court to determine whether it's in the interest of justice that they get that, and to ensure that they're able to follow and understand the trial, to properly instruct counsel or solicitor, and to feel that they're engaged in the trial. So the option of doing the trials remotely is another tool which the court has. But again, as I said earlier, it's open to parties if they disagree with any presumption to challenge that, and the court then has to make the decision in the interests of justice. It's the same with a range of things which we could talk about, the choice of solicitor or counsel, the choice of date, etc. The court has to work in the broader interests of justice and interest of the public rather than the individual interest of the accused. But that's obviously an important factor the court has to take into account in assessing a decision on what's it.
That sort of implies that clearing the backlog is more important than the rights of an individual in Scottish law. I would dispute that.
I don't think that's what I said. I think what the court's got to do is determine what's in the interest of justice, and if the interests of justice are such that the disposing of the case with the accused in a remote location is appropriate, fair, and allows the accused to engage in the way that I've described earlier, then the court can make that decision. But if the court decides that that's not the case, then of course the court would determine that a physical hearing was required.
The big difference, though, is that we're moving from a system of application-based, where if all parties agree to it, the trial can proceed as virtual. And it sounds, from lines of questioning, there have been a very relatively low volume of cases, so it's quite difficult to see what effect that move to virtual has had on outcomes, which is the key point. A point that Katie Clark made is, wouldn't it not be prudent to perform a much wider pilot of trials and volume so you can see the outcome of that, because this bill proposes to move the default to virtual and then it would be application based not to be virtual, which is a complete reverse of the current situation. This isn't an extension of what we're currently doing, this is a big change from what we're currently doing, and that's perhaps the key point.
If I can add, our system is a very traditional system. It has worked since, I think, the Victorian age without major, significant reforms in terms of the process of how we do it. This is a giant leap, and I accept that in terms of moving from the traditional physical court environment into a new digital environment. So you're quite right. There are a lot of questions in terms of actually what does the digital environment and the physical environment, and does that influence or change anything at all? I can only go on what I have had feedback on from primarily the sheriffs that were involved in this, from their perspective, that from their, having done the physical and having done the virtual, they were satisfied that there was no diminution in terms, I'm sure it's the right word, but there was no reduction in terms of what they were able to make their decisions on, whether they were physically in front of them or whether they were on the screen. And I think, but I do take the point that it is uncharted territory at the moment, to a certain degree, but I suppose you have to weigh up what are the benefits against what are the drawbacks of making this change.
Yeah, there is a big difference, though, and I think most people would agree with the premise that virtual witnesses have been beneficial in many cases, for the examples you listed, protecting vulnerable witnesses, especially in domestic abuse cases, and that ability to not be in the same room as the accused has been of benefit, but that existed before the pandemic, to be fair. I want to follow up on a point that the convener made, and you picked up on, where you said the feedback had been overall positive, admittedly, from sheriffs. You also mentioned defence, so we've heard quite the opposite. And I want to quote the specific point that the convener raised earlier from the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association, who said, "I can say on behalf of the vast majority of the profession, I think the experience has been nothing but a resounding failure." That's quite stark comment to make to the Criminal Justice Committee. Do you simply just disagree with that assertion, or will you agree to disagree with them?
No, I would absolutely disagree with that entirely. I don't think that that is the case at all. I think there is a phenomenal amount of success that we have had. I'm not saying that it has not been without its teething issues or, the odd technical issue. which you would get in any transition. And what I would say is, I mean, even our remote jury centres have on occasion, we have lost the links. It has always been down to factors out with our control in relation to the sort of, you know, the broadband connections, but we have got them back up and running very, very quickly. And any transition has that. I know that, some of the difficulties perhaps that the Bar Association have had in relation to the IT can be down to where they are connecting from. For the virtual trials, we have always ensured that we have tested the broadband connection, because we found this out quite early. It really is dependent on where you are coming into the court environment from. It is really is dependent whether you are on a really good broadband network or whether you're on a mobile phone or whether you're on a public Wi-Fi. And you know, we are understanding the reasons why, from some perspective, depending how they are coming into the environment, how it can appear to be actually less than perfect. But the work that our unit has done within the SCTS has actually narrowed down all the different issues over time in terms of, well, what is it that's causing the difficulty or the connection, and resolved them. And I would say that you know, we have made significant progress in terms of making sure that what we have got is a stable environment. And certainly in the court environment, we have made those connections to ensure that they are they're working. So I would absolutely disagree with that.
Okay, that's interesting. I guess their concerns weren't just technical, although they did mention technical issues in certain circumstances. The issue was more a point of principle, I think, is the impression that I got, and that's this concept that the solemnity of a court is sacrosanct in the Scottish legal system. And the quote, I think, that was given by Mr. Murray was that we're dealing with people's lives and their liberty in many cases, in which case the court environment seems to be a prudent place to deal with people's liberty and serve justice. But I might ask the Crown, if I may, just on the numbers here, because I think it's quite key to get an idea of if this legislation does pass and we move to virtual by default on an application exception basis, will that apply only to domestic cases? Would you like to see only apply to those types of cases, or could we see all cases by default start in a virtual setting, but then on a sheriff or a court case-by-case basis move to physical hearings? What sort of numbers are we talking about here in terms of the backlog, how many cases we might have to get through, and are, you know, is this an appropriate way of simply reducing the backlog, or are there other and better ways we could use to reduce the backlog, do you think?
I'm not able to give you numbers. I wouldn't wish to start guessing on that. I can certainly go take that away, and between ourselves and the court service, we could look at whether there's data that we could provide to you. But I'm not going to start flicking things out there. I think it's there are a range of measures available in the legislation to support the reduction of the backlog. This is one which allows us a degree of flexibility to get through some of the business, to get through it in a way which is beneficial for vulnerable victims, which in a way which allows specialism, particularly in more remote areas, for domestic abuse and other types of case. And I think we would want to keep our options open as to whether that's a model which is not just applicable for domestic abuse cases, but which we may also see benefits for in other areas of the business. So I wouldn't want to say that it's only one aspect of the criminal justice system which would benefit from that. I think it's something where that's a crime type which we've identified as a good place to start because of the dynamics of that type of crime and the impact on victims of giving their evidence in a different way, and the benefits of reducing that. But it's a tool which gives us a degree of flexibility about how we best manage the business. There's also a public health aspect of it continuing, whilst we recognise that we're moving away from that, reducing the footfall within public spaces, I think, is still a welcome benefit of this piece of legislation as we move forward. That need hopefully will continue to reduce, but it's another aspect of this piece of legislation which allows the court to manage the volume of business and therefore the risks of the number of people that can be in a courtroom at any given time.
I appreciate there's other questions, so I'll have
okay, thanks very much. I'll bring in... did you want to come in, David?
May I just a little bit to your question? In summary, cases that we still have awaiting trial, it's roughly about 26,000 cases that are non-domestic abuse and 6,000 cases that are domestic abuse. I think in terms of the question you raised, that if the legislation was purely for domestic abuse, it would allow us, which was Clark's point, us to actually have a little bit more in terms of being able to pilot, if you like, notwithstanding it is legislation, because it is only dealing with 6,000 as opposed to the 33,000 cases that we have. So there is an element of containment if it is purely for domestic abuse cases.
Okay, thanks very much. I wonder if I can just come in very quickly with a question, probably for yourself, David. Just more in relation to the civil side of cases. My understanding is that almost all sort of civil and tribunal business has been undertaken either online or by phone, obviously during the pandemic. And I just wondered if you could maybe update members on whether this is likely to continue, how long for, etc.
Yes, we managed to get on the civil side the transfer to the digital environment much more quickly than we were on the criminal side. And I think I've said, I mean, we have no delays or backlogs in terms of the civil side. It is not really a matter for me in terms of where the future, I think it's for the Civil Rules Council at the moment, who are looking at whether procedural or evidence giving and what the breakdown would be and what would be appropriate. I think what I can say is that the move to having procedural hearings digitally and a lot of the other hearings digitally, I think the profession have welcomed on the civil side. And I do see it as steps forward, but it's not for SCTS, I think, to set out what that future may look like. I know that the Lord President and Lord Justice Clark have views in terms of how they would like to see it progress. And I think it's a positive step in terms of what we've been able to do, but I'm sorry, I'm not able to specifically answer what lies ahead of us on that front.
Yeah, no, that's helpful. Okay, I'll bring in Russell Finlay. I think we've got a couple of other sort of themes that we'd like to cover off, but I'll bring in Russell.
It's just a small point that relates to the written evidence from SCTS. It talks about virtual trials helping reduce the justice sector's carbon footprint. Is that something you've measured?
It isn't. And it is based purely on the fact that we haven't got people coming to and from courts and giving evidence without that. So it hasn't been quantified in any way.
Right. Okay. And finally, Mr. Dorley, in respect of multiple accused solemn trials, many of these, as the evidence, written evidence says, relate to organised crime. Yeah. Can you quantify the backlog in that respect? Cases of that nature?
I don't have it with me, but I can get that for you. They're not all organised crime cases, so that, you know, there's multiple accused cases in a range of the business. We have made some progress with that. Initially, when we introduced the jury centre model, we weren't able to do, I think it was more than two or three accused cases. We've now got a couple of facilities that enable us to do that, so we have started to address some of those cases, but obviously there are more of them in the stocks than we would like to be the case, just because there was a period of time where we couldn't do any of them at all. I think that's fair, David, unless you think otherwise.
Yes. At the very start of the pandemic, I mean, it was a single or two accused, I think, that we could do. We have vintage facilities that most facilities is up to five, we can do up to nine. I think we had an 11 accused scheduled, but it pled, so we didn't have to use that. So we are able to deal with multi-accused now, where in the early stages we weren't.
So up to nine is the rough kind of territory.
Yeah, but we can, I mean, using a two-court model, we can go beyond that. Right. It just impacts, of course, in the other business that we're getting through when we have to do that.
Thank you.
Take to do an analysis of the caseload at the moment and give you details of the multiple accused cases and the general crime type, if that would assist.
Perhaps, and also, I suppose, just the disproportionate delays in respect of them, which seems likely, if that could be quantified, compared to single accused. Or
That's quite a nuanced analysis, yeah. But I'll see what I can do.
No worries. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay, we'll just move swiftly on. I think some members have got some questions around time limits in criminal cases, so I'll maybe hand back to Jamie and then I'll bring in Fulton.
I think we understand the concept of increasing the time limits so that cases don't time out, and I think that's entirely appropriate. It's difficult to argue against that. But obviously, increasing those have a substantial impact on both parties, the victims themselves, and of course those who are accused, particularly those who are accused and held on remand. Can I ask, other than not allowing the cases to time out, what possible justification is there for extending the time limits of cases? Or is that the only reason, the only suitable reason?
Do you want to go?
From the court's perspective, without that, we would be facing, there is a mechanism where an application can be made to the court and it will be up to the individual, as sheriff or judge, to make the decision whether or not that happens. What that would mean is for the vast volume of cases that are within the system, it would take away from resources in order to deal with that. And you might think, well, how long does it take to do that? But if you're talking about, you know, thousands, that will have to be scheduled in, which means we're not able to actually do trials while the judiciary are doing that. And that would probably be the biggest dimension from STS's perspective, is it allows us to focus on actually dealing with the backlog and dealing with getting cases through the court, as opposed to dealing with an administrative procedure.
Mm. So is there a better way of doing this then? I mean, it sounds to me like the process of having to apply for individual case-by-case extensions is quite laborious and time-consuming for the courts. Therefore, just a default extension automatically means that cases can just take longer to come to pass. We're talking here, though, if the backlog is about 4 years away for some, now that's even beyond the statutory maximums, even after they've been extended. Many people have given evidence that they're concerned about the nature and the length of the extensions. In some cases, up to a year, for example, being held on remand. In some cases, people may be held on remand for much longer than their sentence ever might have been. There are serious implications and international norms which are being breached as a result of this extension. Does anyone have a view on that?
That's probably one for Mr. Donnelly. What I would say, though, in terms of the delays is... and I absolutely accept that from commission or, you know, alleged offence taking place to final disposal is up, you know, is 4 years. Once you're into the court environment, I mean, we normally will have dealt with High Court trials within 6 months, and it now takes 12 months. So there's a 6 month extension within our part of the system, if you like. But in relation to the pre-court, Mr. Donald.
Okay, so. I think I mentioned earlier, when I can't remember in response to whom, but there are pressures on the system all the way through the system, and there are backlogs of work all the way through the system, and everything is taking longer to do than was previously the case. So each case is coming in, it takes longer to gather all the materials, it takes longer to get the scientific and forensic telephony, cybercrime reports. All of that is working in a different environment, and everything is coming in slower than would ordinarily be the case, and so the whole process is slow. In addition, there's the management of the increased workload. So again, I think the written evidence gave the example that the High Court, the overall business of the High Court, the increase was, I think, something in the region of 55%. So all that work is having to be processed. And what we're saying about the time limits, yes, they're important, but it's important that we have the right tools to allow us to get through this backlog of work that's grown over the course of the pandemic. Without it, we would be having to prepare cases and to perhaps indict them in a way which was incomplete and unsatisfactory, and so you're then at the mercy of the court to try and have the cases individually called in and continued. And I think there'll be challenges for defence preparation as well, but I can't speak for the defence. I'm sure they'll speak for themselves. But certainly the challenges in preparation, you could be indicting cases that are not complete, but because the time limits are there, the option is actually an application to the court for more time to prepare, or you go into court with a half half-prepared product in the hope that you get more time to finish the product. Yeah. So none of that's satisfactory. The real challenge in all of this is that the court is overwhelmed with business. There's an overwhelming amount of business that hasn't yet reached the court that's going to be having to come through as we clear out the backlogs at the different stages in the process. And the danger of not having the extended time periods, from my point of view, is that the court then becomes so busy in the administration of the process and the justice rather than in the delivery of the outcome of the justice process. So that I'm not convinced, and again, I think the evidence would show that if we didn't have the periods, we would end up having to ask the court and getting similar extensions of time. It would just be that we would be taking up court time, lawyer time, clerk time, which would be better utilised actually dealing with the disposal of business at trial.
How are you going to decide what cases to prioritise? So, for example, cases where someone is being held on remand versus someone who isn't, who's on licence or on bail. Is it cases of gender-based sexual violence or domestic abuse? Is it cases that are more of serious nature that you think require more immediate disposal?
Sure.
The biggest point of feedback we often get from victims of crime is simply the lack of communication. Okay. And the not knowing and not understanding why cases have been delayed or are being put off repeatedly, in this case for a number of years, and that's a huge cause of concern for many victims.
Okay. So I'll go first this time, David, you'll be pleased to know. Buck the trend. The prioritisation is a difficult one. Priority is given to those who are on remand, obviously, because their liberty's been deprived, but you have to look at that in the context of a range of priorities. And so if you've got looking at the High Court, every case in the High Court has a degree of priority, whether it's sexual offending, a homicide, a road traffic fatality, and not all of them will be on remand. And again, the percentage of, I think we mentioned in our submission that broadly speaking, the High Court business, you'll forgive me if I keep using that as an example, it's where I worked up until about a few weeks ago, so it's where I'm most familiar with, but 67% of the business roughly is sexual offences. That increases the further on you go in the process, because they're the cases which resolve less often by way of plea negotiation. Right. So they're the ones which tend to more often go to trial. Only a quick analysis of our work in progress yesterday, of the sexual offence cases, only 13% of them are custody cases. Whereas if you compare that to homicides, it's over 50%. Similarly with major crimes, which is everything beyond between homicide and sexual crime, it's over 30%. So, in fact, I'm saying it's over 30, it might even be higher than that. But it's so that there's a real difficulty in trying to prioritise everything in a range of priorities. And so the court, once we've indicted the cases, of course, responsible for scheduling and for that degree of prioritisation. There are a whole number of moving parts. You know, the availability of counsel for the accused can be an issue if they're particularly busy, and the court trying to fix a date that suits their needs, the availability of witnesses. I mentioned earlier the availability of expert witnesses can be a real challenge. So there's a whole range of moving parts in trying to schedule the business, but certainly top of the list of priorities is those whose liberty has been denied.
Thank you, Peter.
Thank you. Fulton, are you wanting to pick up on anything for time limits, Fulton?
Yeah, yep. So just briefly, convener. I think we're all a bit worried. I mean, I can hear that from yourself about the backlog and what it might mean. It's really good to hear at the start that you do feel we're on track to have that cleared. I wanted to ask about other possible solutions that you might have or options, and that's around the prosecution of minor offences. I wonder if you can talk about that and how they would be identified and prioritised if you were to look at those no longer been taken forward. And I guess just to add on to that question, convener, just to add it all together, how will you take into account, given the time period, change in people's circumstances? And the two examples I'd give is obviously the remand one. You've said that's a priority, but you could be looking at a case where somebody could have already been in remand for longer than maybe the maximum disposal they could get. So that is obviously something that you'd imagine would be taken into account. And also in situations that are more minor within the community where they're not remanded, perhaps, you know, would there be scope to look at situations that have almost resolved themselves, where, you know, the accused and the victim have actually, you know, as we know happens quite a lot, have actually, repaired the situation themselves, and there's been situations around that. Are these things that are taken into account when you're looking at, you know, prioritising what cases to look at?
Okay, so there's a number of issues in there. I'll try and deal with them quickly. So the when you mentioned the prioritisation of lower level crime, the lower level crime, obviously, if we're looking at it from the point of view of the discussion earlier on about fiscal fines, we try and deal with as much of that business by alternatives to prosecution as we can to remove that from the system so that the system's got capacity. Thereafter, prosecution policy is set by the Lord Advocate, and we obviously, once that policy is set, we'll look at cases on a case-by-case basis. It may sound like a cliche, but it's true that every case is looked at in its own facts and circumstances, looked at in the circumstances of the offence, the offender, the impact on victims, and obviously decisions are then made about the appropriate forum for the case. Those policies were adjusted at the point of the pandemic to allow us to make decisions which hopefully support recovery. They'll be kept under review. All cases are kept under review as they go. So if the dynamic of a case has changed, or if it becomes too old, if you know, there are a range of options open to a prosecutor every time they look at a case to determine whether or not it continues to be in the public interest to continue with that case. And that's something that we do innately in every case that we deal with. When you pick up a bundle of papers, the first thing you think of is it still in the public interest for this to continue? But you have to obviously weigh up a number of factors in that. It's not just about the age of the case. You'll have to look at the impact on the victim, the seriousness of the offence, and also the offender's situation. In terms of remand, for those who are on remand, again, the court, I think we referenced in our written submission, the court gave a fairly clear indication early in the pandemic that the approach to bail should be. That's a decision of the court. If someone was in custody for a period which would exceed the length of their sentence, then it would be open to them to apply to the court to have their bail reviewed. And obviously that would be a factor that the court would have to take into account in looking at that. As if there was a maximum sentence for the crime charged, then that period has already elapsed, or the period that would be served, then it's a factor the court would take into account considering whether or not it was appropriate to continue with remand. So each case is individual. I hope I've picked up all the points there. I'm not sure if I did. I maybe missed one, but I don't know if there's anything you want to add to that, David, from the point of view of the court. But
not from the court perspective, thank you.
No, thanks for that. And I think the question that was getting at, which you've answered well, was about the public interest in those cases, because if you're talking about significant periods of time, there can be significant changes to the situations. Particularly in more minor situations, I think the most serious cases, you know, there's probably still more public interest there because they can be open to psychological and emotional abuse as well. But in more minor situations, you know, the one I had in my head was sort of youth offending, for example. I mean, a kid could be 16, and if it's going on quite a long time, they might be 20, and they might have repaired, you know, some of the issues with their community and stuff like that. So I'll not labour the point.
It's not uncommon for agents on behalf of people in that situation to write to the Crown and ask the Crown to reconsider the public interest in the case and set out the change of circumstances and to assess whether the public interest is still there. That's been the case all of my career and continues to be the case. And as I say, it's something that we instinctively do anyway, and but we don't always have the detail of the information of what the evolution of the offender's situation is. And so if and when the agent will write us, we would certainly look at that and consider the viability of the ongoing public interest in the case.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay, I think we're going to have to bring the session to a close. I know there were one or two other questions, but time is against us. So many thanks, Kenny and David, for joining us today. Obviously, if there's anything that I think there are a number of bits of follow-up that you have undertaken to do for us, which is very helpful and appreciated. So big thank you for attending, and we'll just take a short break while we allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you very much. Welcome back. Our next item of business this morning is our final evidence session on the justice provisions in the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Bill. And I'm very pleased to welcome to today's meeting Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans, Jeff Gibbons from the Criminal Justice Division, and Louise Miller from the Legal Directorate. And officials attending online are Stephen McGregor, Cabinet, Parliament and Governance Division, Jennifer Stoddart, Community Justice Division, and Joanne Tinto, Legal Directorate of the Scottish Government. So we very much appreciate the time that you're taking to join us this morning. So I intend to allow around an hour for questions and answers, and as usual, I would ask for them to be succinct. And I'd like to invite the Cabinet Secretary to make some brief opening remarks. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks for the opportunity to provide an opening statement on the justice provisions contained within the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill, and also to thank all those who engaged in the 12-week consultation process, which, of course, helped inform the development of the bill, and those who provided written and oral evidence to the committee. The vast majority of the justice provisions detailed within the bill are being progressed on a longer extension basis. This is in the context of the Justice Recovery Programme, the Vision for Justice published last month, and against the background of the backlog of cases as a result of the pandemic. Over the course of the pandemic, we have seen significant changes in how the justice system has operated and adapted to changes in working practices as it's responded to public health guidance. Public safety has been the paramount consideration throughout and consequently required a change in how we work. That consideration clearly remains, as does a recognition that public attitudes to travel and general day-to-day activities will have been shaped by people's experiences of the pandemic. Much of what we will discuss today, I expect, will be firmly rooted within the Justice Recover, Renew, Transform programme. And the measures in that programme of work have contributed to recovering a viable justice system, responding flexibly to meet the challenges which COVID-19 presents, whilst delivering a more effective and efficient justice system now and for the future. And this is fundamental to protecting our rights and freedoms and to addressing inequality. The justice system has and it continues to respond to the challenges presented by the pandemic and societal changes that we must adapt to. Many of the technological changes introduced, such as virtual custody hearings, the operation of remote jury centres and the electronic transmission of documents, have proven to be a successful response to the new working environment. As the committee has heard in its evidence sessions, for some, these changes are seen as temporary measures to address the problems caused by the pandemic and ought only to apply in that context. Others, however, see an opportunity for transformational change that could form part of a new justice system for Scotland. In common with the committee, I agree it's essential that we fully evaluate the impact of these measures operationally and on court users before they could be considered a permanent feature. Also, there will be some changes that are only ever temporary and that the Scottish Government have no intention of making permanent. For example, the extended time limits are purely to address the impact of the pandemic on the criminal courts. Equally, I can provide reassurance that powers which are no longer required will not continue to be used. That's why the bill includes suggested annual milestones through which these provisions can be reassessed regularly. Powers are in the bill for measures to be expired or suspended ahead of these annual milestones, and the government remains committed to expiring or suspending any existing provisions that are no longer necessary. It's proposed that measures requiring to be extended beyond November 2023 can be extended by regulations using the draft affirmative procedure through potentially to November 2025. And that means appropriate parliamentary scrutiny can take place and places a clear onus on all justice organisations to evidence how the powers have been used and to make the case for their retention. In addition, and in an effort to be open and transparent, the policy memorandum also highlights areas where potential Stage 2 amendments may be progressed, noting other areas of activity which may have an impact. I've listened carefully to the evidence sessions over the last 2 weeks and to some extent this morning. It's clear there are a range of views on how best to respond to the impact of the pandemic on the justice system and the opportunities and challenges raised for all of us. But there's no doubt there is agreement on the impact that has been had on the justice system by the pandemic. And I take all the comments on board and trust as we consider the provisions and their individual and collective impacts that we can respond and address points of concern carefully and directly as a Parliament. And happy to take questions, Convener.
Thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary, for that update. So, as you say, we'll just open or move straight on to questions. And if I may, I would like to ask an opening question. And it's around early release of prisoners. Now, I know that we will be looking at a separate agenda item on risk assessment later on, but I'd like to focus on early release in the context of the COVID-19 pandemic and the provisions within the bill. I'm aware that in my own area, in the North East, for example, early release was something that saw very close collaboration across agencies who worked well together, as I saw it, particularly in the context of prisoner release from HMP Grampian. And the risk assessment and other processes were informed and robust, particularly around issues also such as through care and victim contact. But I know there are some concerns about that particular aspect of the early release process that was undertaken, and albeit I recognise that the last early release was back in 2020. So I'm interested, obviously, you've mentioned that the powers that are no longer required within the criminal justice system will not be used. But I just wondered if you have any more comment around the issues of early release and whether or not you feel that those provisions would require or could be improved or adapted, and whether actually they would be required at all.
I think it's true to say that we are only looking at a temporary extension to that power for the purposes of the pandemic, but it's also true to say we are consulting on that becoming a permanent power through separate legislation. And it is a feature of UK government. They have that power embedded in legislation, it seems to me, for reasons to do with, I suppose, contingency planning. But the same kind of argument would apply in relation to this, I think, Convener, that if you're having to do it as a response to something which is hit unexpectedly, perhaps you don't have all the time that you'd like to take to do as much in terms of consultation and forward thinking as you would like. And I know there were certain, it was before that my time as Justice Secretary, obviously, but there were concerns whether through care had enough time to be effective. Also, victims, whether notification was as effective as it could be. All I would say is that we will have learnt lessons from that and seek to apply them to any future release, although we have no early releases planned. And even if we can take our best guess at the pandemic just now, it doesn't seem to be anything like what it was previously in terms of its impact on society. So this is a contingency power for those reasons. Just to say one word widely, mass releases of prisoners are a feature of systems across the world, Texas, Georgia, different countries as well. We don't intend to use it for anything other than, for example, in California, the state was told by its Supreme Court to have released around a third of its prisoners more or less overnight because we're at 120% capacity. We're not in that situation. What we're looking for is a temporary extension to this power if the pandemic was to justify us doing that.
Mm-hmm. Thanks very much. And I suppose just another point around the aspect of early release is that of public safety. And I know that Police Scotland, they have made some commentary around that being a priority, which I don't think anybody would disagree with. So, again, it was just to ask if the process for assessing risk in the context of early release has, I suppose, public safety at its heart, and that will continue.
Yes, I think that was evident. Again, it predates my time, but it was evident in the criteria that were set for those that were to be released, you know, had to be very close to the release date. There were certain categories of offenders that were not to be included in that as well. Attention's been drawn to the reconviction rate, which is sometimes confused with those who are readmitted to custody, which can be a different thing, which I think was around, from memory, about 40%. But in relation to the categories of prisoners that were released, that was not at all unusual. For short sentences, you're looking at 50 and sometimes 60% of reconvictions. But yes, of course, there would be assessment done on public safety. And I think I'm right in saying, and I'm sure I'll be corrected if I'm wrong, that the categories of prisoners which were agreed to be released took into account the risk to public safety. And it was agreed, I think, by all parties in the Parliament at that time. And we would hope to try and achieve that again if it was necessary to do so.
Thanks very much. OK, I will hand straight over to Russell Finlay. We've got a number of questions. It will be of no surprise around court business by electronic means. So, Russell, over to you.
Yeah, hi there. The first question was something I was going to ask the previous two witnesses, but ran out of time. Now, the written evidence we saw from the Crown Office is there's 850 High Court cases on indictment that have yet to be allocated a trial date yet. And we know there's tens of thousands of summary cases. Was any consideration given to clear this backlog by working weekends, opening the courts up at weekends?
Well, the changes that we have made, and yes, that was mentioned, discussed and so on, as were all possible means by which we could reduce the backlog. But it has to be borne in mind, I think, that the whole system has to be ready to do that. It's not just to have a courtroom available or a remote jury centre, if that was applicable, available. And we thought that the stress on the court system generally and what was being asked of them could not be sustained if that was to be done on a seven-day-a-week basis. I know it has been done. You've had 90 Gael courses, down south, but we thought, given the pressures on the system, and it might be worth hearing from officials as to some of those pressures, that what we've done in terms of putting the money in the around £50 million this year into the additional courts, 16 additional courts, was the most effective way to do that. But I don't know if officials want to say more about that.
Just to add, broadly, we've been looking at lots of different options to address the backlog, but the broader question around capacity within the system, the resource and the impact on all the partners is one of the key issues to address. And as you've heard from some previous evidence sessions, clearly there's mounting pressure in some of those in terms of managing the workload as it is before expanding it further. So those are some of the key issues that have been informing some of that decision making.
So were the various stakeholders asked about working weekends?
Again, some of that predates my time as Justice Secretary, but we've had a constant dialogue with all the Justice partners in relation to this. And I think if you think about the 16 additional courts, I mean, that's court service staff, that's defence lawyers, that's prosecutorial staff, sheriffs and so on, that's a very big increase in their workload. So, again, we thought that was the most effective way to do it. And actually, I still do think that's a more effective way to do it. Obviously, others might have different ideas about it, but we think that was the way to do it. And it was done on the basis of maximum consultation with justice partners. You can't really do something as radical as that without, as we have done, without having the consent and discussion and consultation with justice partners.
Okay, thank you. And just touching on a subject that you've already mentioned in respect of reoffending, the statistics are of the 348 that were released early, 142 went on to reoffend. Just 40% within 6 months. First of all, do you consider that to be acceptable? And if this were to happen again, would the same procedures apply, or has any work been done to attempt to improve the risk to the public?
Well, I think, first of all, no, I don't consider any offence acceptable. I think that's probably true of everyone in the justice system. But I think it's also true to say, as I mentioned already, that there's a level of reconviction which is associated with especially short sentences. And again, Jennifer Stoddart might want to come in this, which is true across different jurisdictions, 50-60%, which is one reason why we have, of course, in recent years seen a change to a presumption against short sentences, not a bar on them, but a presumption against them, because they're ineffective very often. It's also one of the principles and values that underlies the justice vision, which we've just published, that we think community sentencing very often is much more effective. It has lower conviction rates. So, no, we don't find it acceptable. We do want to try and drive those down. And if anything, I suppose, you quite rightly ask, what would we do now that would show, having learned lessons from that might reduce it? Then I think the community justice side of things has to be better prepared. It was not, of course, without its own impacts from the pandemic. whether it was staff or the places that they had to work in. But if we could have more availability in relation to that, so that we were tapping into that reduction in reconvictions, that would be one lesson I would want to learn. So making sure the community justice system is able to rise to that challenge. Were we to have that further early release of prisoners, we're just underlined once again, we have no current plans to have that release. But I wonder if it would be worth hearing from Jennifer, because she would have been there at the time when this was decided last time.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Just to echo the points that Mr Brown made, I mean, these were very short-term prisoners that were included in the release, so those serving less than 18 months, and it is very difficult when someone is in custody for such a short time to address underlying causes of their offending. That's not to excuse any reoffending that occurred after they were released. But certainly this is part of our wider consideration of how we can reduce the use of imprisonment, particularly short-term imprisonment. So for any future use of this power, which is absolutely not planned and would not be something that we would choose to do, we would be working with our community justice partners to offer through care support to these individuals as they are released. And that engagement did take place during the use of this power. The first time the prison service engaged with local authorities so that support could be offered to these individuals. But as happens in normal release for short-term prisoners, they do not have to take up that support.
I suppose just very, very quickly, just, and it's all theoretical, but if that were to happen, there is no mechanism to force early release prisoners to engage. It would just be on the basis of goodwill on their part. Is that correct?
It would depend on the cohort of prisoner which was included. So long-term prisoners, if they were to be included, and they were not included in this cohort, but if long-term prisoners were to be included, then they would be required to engage with social work as they would in normal processes. They release as a statutory requirement. There are no plans to, if we were to use this again for short-term prisoners, the legislation as it stands does not allow the requirement for those individuals to engage with services. Short-term prisoners at the moment under current legislation are not required to engage with through care, although they are offered it either from the third sector or from local authority.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Yep. Thanks very much. We'll stick with electronic court options. Russell, do you want to pick up some questions on that? Or?
I'm okay just now.
Okay, yeah, thanks very much. In that case, I'll maybe bring in Rona Mackay and then Jamie Green after that.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. You'll be aware that we've heard support for the greater use of virtual options. We've also heard concerns, so mixed views. So the concerns that we've heard is that it can prevent effective communication between legal representatives and our clients. It can impede the assessment of the credibility of witnesses and discriminate against people who don't have access to digital technology. I just wondered what your thoughts were on that and if it was being addressed.
Yes, I think especially if we were to look to doing this permanently, may be possible through other legislative processes which are coming forward. We are looking at this, and I heard the evidence that was given to the committee by the Bar Association and so on, and some of the concerns they had raised. I mean, also the faculty have raised the issue about digital exclusion, which we are doing. I think that was raised with us a number of months ago, which we're looking to address. However, on the other side, as recently as yesterday, you would have heard, I think it was Rhoda Grant saying about how beneficial it can be in cases of domestic abuse and also in rural areas. So there are, as ever, arguments on both sides. We'd want to take those things into account, learning from the pilots before proceeding further. It is possible, of course, that the judiciary, given their powers, could advance with this in the meantime, to some extent, with a practice note. I think their preference would be to have legislation for the reasons that you mentioned. There's a lot of things to work through in relation to this. It seems on the surface very appealing, but especially those most closely involved in the process, defence representatives and others, they do have some concerns. We'd want to try and address those as best we could.
Do you see that as being a problem, you know, that
the concerns from one side of the legal profession as opposed to the other, because we've heard quite opposing views, and I'm just wondering if that could ever really be bridged, the gap because of the sort of traditional practices of, let's just say, defence lawyers, and the court service who are thinking it's a good tool to have, an option to have to clear the backlog, and also, as you say, for domestic abuse victims and vulnerable witnesses, and we know that is very much favoured by the third sector organisations. So,
I maybe ask Jeff to come in this, but I think, as a layperson, I think it could be bridged. I'm not saying I have the answers to that just now, but a lot of the qualms which have been raised by legal representatives have been about, looking somebody in the eye and that kind of presence, and the faculty said it's the presence in the courtroom, being able to read somebody's reactions, body language and things like that are extremely important. And I think there may well be, I say this just now without having the expertise, maybe digital solutions to some of that, to improve on some of that. And I would hope that it could be bridged, because I think some of the benefits, we've heard about vulnerable witnesses, obviously, but people have to travel a long way. The issue that was raised yesterday about domestic abuse, potentially huge benefits, but we'd want to try and take the profession with us. And you're absolutely right to say that even, I think, within and between the Law Society and Bar Associations, there are different points of view. So I think it must be possible to reach a potential agreement, but it will take some work to do that and listen to people's concerns. I don't know if Jeff wants to come in on that.
Yeah, I think that in some ways evidence why we've gone for a longer extension approach, because we recognise there's a variety of views. Sometimes they're quite contrasting over similar issues, and they get quite confused. So I think we will bridge the gap in terms of we continue to work with stakeholders to see what a virtual offer might look like that's acceptable to all, that addresses the resource issues, the positives, and addresses some of the anecdotal comments that people make about some of the issues that have been raised, to quantify those to some extent as well, because we need the evidence base to support moving forward. So both in a civil and in a criminal context, very much an evidence-based approach to how virtual might look in a future justice system. But we worked with the stakeholders on the long extension approach and got their support for that, and again, we continue to discuss with them what a virtual justice system in Scotland might look like going forward.
Yeah, I mean, I just think we've come very far in the space of 2 years with the huge changes that have had to be imposed because of COVID. And it probably will take a bit longer to actually reach consensus for that to go forward. I hope it can, because it's certainly beneficial to a lot of people, I think.
I think some of the views around disagreement has been around one particular report, but that's more about the mechanism to move that forward. So, as you'd be aware, the work from the virtual trials group published after the legislation was introduced, it's got positivity, but there was a limited number of trials involved, so the sort of context of evaluation is quite limited. It was also uncosted, so we need to look at what the resource issues are, being picking up points that Mr. Finney made earlier about how that resource in one area affects other areas as well. So it's very much looking at what a future legislative option might be, but also future-proofing that, because technology moves so quickly, we don't want to look at it just at this point in time, but what's a virtual offering going forward might look like, and how can the legislation adapt quickly to that going forward rather than having to create revisits as well. So we are in agreement. I think it's more about how we move it forward and the kind of timing frame, I think, is around that.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
Okay, thanks very much. I'll bring in Jamie Green now. I know you've got some questions, just going back to the issue around early release, but if we'll maybe stick with the electronic court options for the moment, and then I will bring in Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Convener. I'll be happy to come back in later on other questions. Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned that you'd read and listened to a number of the evidence sessions we've had. As other members have alluded to, there is a difference of opinion on the success or otherwise of virtual trials. I think I just want to clarify the difference between the government's proposals around the ongoing ability for people to give evidence virtually, which I think we found to be helpful, beneficial for witnesses, specialists, and of course those most vulnerable in specific cases, versus complete full trials, of which we've also heard there have been very few. so we don't really know what effect they have. The question I posed to the previous panel, which I'll pose again, is would it not be more prudent to conduct a much wider pilot of virtual trials before we embed in legislation any permanency to such trials?
Yes, and I think, although it has to be said, that's got to be done by the judiciary. It can't be done by the government. The judiciary decide on court business, its format and how it's run, although we've encouraged that. And I think we are lucky in both Sheriff Principal Pyle and the Lord President are very keen to see innovation happen. So that would, I think, would require certainly their consent and possibly their initiative to do that. However, I think your point is right. If you want to do this, you have to have a stronger evidence base. And I've been asked, why have we not included that in this bill? Well, it is not strictly speaking about COVID. That's not what this, I know it may be a beneficial impact, but it's about different purposes. So I have seen Parliament get quite annoyed about things which they don't consider are directly related to the pandemic in terms of emergency or exceptional legislation. So I think if this is a more permanent change, then it's got to be evidenced. We have to try and work through some of the differences, and we would have to work with the judiciary. Of course, Parliament can always decide itself if it wants to change something fundamentally, but in relation to a pilot, and of course there is the potential to have more virtual trials just now under the direction of the Lord President and others. So yes, if that was the answer, I think we should have more of an evidence base before we move forward on this. Yeah,
that's really helpful. So just to clarify, then, nothing in the COVID legislation that we're talking about today will move to a default of virtual trials that can then be excluded on an application basis for physical, whereas at the moment all parties have to consent. And if all parties do not consent, then there will be a physical trial. Will this legislation change that in any way?
Well, first of all, it could change in one of two ways. Maybe I'll get the officials to make sure that I'm getting this right. But it could change without the legislation. So and there are discussions continuing as to how that might be achieved with the consent of different partners. So it could change without the legislation. But this legislation is rolling over what we currently have. So the default position is physical courts. But please correct me if I'm getting that wrong.
No, I think the point around the report from Sheriff Principal Pyle was about a presumption that they thought should be introduced into the legislation to underpin the practice note that's been supporting the pilot to date. I think that's the point. That's something that that we feel needs further consultation because it has a broader impact. And as I said earlier, we need to look at future-proofing that to some degree. So the ability that the legislation is, in the COVID, in this bill, does not change anything that was there before, but we have an eye on the ask within that report about a future change in legislation, but we would need to consult on that and come forward about the evidence base to support that.
Okay, so on a technical level, this is an extension of temporary powers. Are these time limited or is this a permanent extension?
No, these are long extension provisions until 2025 as the stopgap point.
Okay, that's actually very helpful. I'm all for consultation, as the Cabinet Secretary knows. Some of the other issues that were raised are around some of the practicalities of it. We've heard some criticism of the way in which some virtual and electronic means of conducting businesses have taken place. The main gripe from the defence sector seems to be that inability to work on a one-to-one basis with an accused, the ability to sit with them in the same room and counsel appropriately. Is that a concern that's been taken on board? Because there seemed to be much disagreement in the last panel as to the scale of how much this is a problem to solicitors or the bar, who seem to think that the whole thing's just an unmitigated disaster, according to their evidence given to us. But on the other hand, it's an unmitigated success, according to other panellists. So, you know, I don't know where we sit in terms of the reality of this. It seems to be just one word against another in terms of the context. Where does the government think we sit here?
Well, I think your starting point was, are we listening to that and taking that seriously? And yes, we are. I think it goes to the point of we're trying to improve it. And my response to Rona Mackay, which was we should listen to this and see if there's a way we can try and achieve agreement. Although you're absolutely right to say, even within
defence solicitors, there are the extremes of views that you've mentioned, not just from different panellists that you've heard from different organisations, but even within, say, the Law Society or the Bar Associations, there are very different points of view. Again, maybe Jeff can add to this, but yes, we want to listen to that. Is there a way that we can help with that? I think that's, if that's felt by people on the front line trying to be as effective as they can be for their clients, and we have to listen to it, and is there a way that we can overcome that? It's hard to see if you're all virtual how you can do that, but there may be exceptions to it, I suppose. So we're, the government sits willing to listen to possible remedies, and of course we've got a lot of very good people in government. Perhaps they can help us find solutions in tandem with the justice partners that we have.
Yeah, we're very aware of the differing views around success or otherwise, and some of that is anecdotal and not really supported by much evidence. Some of that is clearly coming through, and the court responds to those accordingly. We understand they've addressed some of those concerns when they've been raised, whether it's an adjournment or whatever is required to address when they are. We're not entirely sure of the level, to be perfectly frank, and that's part of the evidence base, the extent to which those were concerns were that came with the early introduction of virtual, or whether there's something that continues. So that's something that is part of that ongoing evaluation about making sure that where people feel disengaged with the process, that's been addressed and minimised. I think it's also worth adding that on the flip side, where we have had positive, really positive and evidenced response is where we've engaged with disabilities groups, where they see the digital adoption by the court service as something that's enabled their greater inclusion in the justice system, and in fact many of which have been pushing for that for a number of years and were quite surprised that it finally came around for this reason alone. So there's evidence positives, but equally we're well aware that there are still ongoing concerns, so that's another reason to do a longer extension clearly before you look to do anything permanent.
One thing which might help Mr. Green listen to this, I think the government is not just listening and eager to act to see if we can try and get agreement. If this is something that would require additional resources, you know, to help that process, given the impact it has, particularly on defence lawyers, then we would be willing to look at that as well. We are keen to do this for the reasons that Rona Mackay mentioned, but also because of the help it will give us, of course, in addressing the backlog. So we stand ready to support that if we can.
You preempted my last question. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. On resource, and I guess that is linked into funding as well, are you satisfied that the Crown, the defence sector, all the stakeholders involved, the SCTS, have sufficient people, place and money to clear the backlog by 2026? Because given the last evidence session we just had, it sounds like there are significant pressures in processing all aspects of a case, from someone being charged right through to a court disposal. Every stage of it, there are new and additional pressures. So what's your level of confidence that that backlog will be cleared in 4 years, which already is admittedly a long time?
Yeah, and I think it's worth saying at the start, I know Mr. Green will understand this, but perhaps others listening might not, that we're not saying that somebody who has a court case coming up now will have to wait 4 years for that to be addressed, but the backlog itself will take 4 years in some cases to be addressed. Yes, I do have that confidence, and it's based on what those partners that you mentioned, whether it's Crown Office or the Court Service, tell me. They've given me these dates as they've given them to the committee as well, and we've obviously analysed and explored them at some length. I think that does include, though, a willingness of everybody to look for other innovative ways in which we can address some of the issues that maybe stand in the way of having a quicker throughput of cases. And you come up against some hard blocks which you'll not be able to overcome. Going back to Mr. Finlay's question, the number of people involved in this process is only so much you can do in terms of the people that are there delivering a service through all the different courts that we've mentioned. So, yes, I have that confidence from what I'm told from justice partners and the discussions we've had with them, but I fully expect that we're going to have to find further innovations along the way to make sure that we achieve it.
Thank you, Convener.
Very much. Okay, I'll bring in Fulton McGregor now, and I think that's and Russell. You wanted to come in after that? No.
Okay. Yes, please. Okay, thanks, Convener, and still good morning to Cabinet Secretary and the panel. before I ask my question, a couple of months ago, it might have been longer, This committee met with some vulnerable witnesses who had been through the court systems, and we heard their harrowing experience of our witnesses and victims, in some cases alleged victims, of some of the most harrowing offences, as you know about. And one of the things that this committee committed to do as members was to make sure that their experiences, although given to us privately, were fed back when we got the opportunity to do so. So on the basis of that, going back to an earlier part of the discussion when we're talking about some of the evidence we heard from defence lawyers last week about needing to see the accuser and needing to interpret body language, some of the stuff that we heard actually said that, you know, for people who had experienced these offences, if they went in and they presented as confident and capable, it went against them, or they felt it went against them. If they went in and it all sort of broke down for them, then that would also potentially go against them. So I think it's worthwhile, you know, highlighting that context, and probably gives an indication of why I personally, and I know other members of the same, supportive of a move to is more remote and not needing to be present in the court for as many vulnerable witnesses as possible. And the last evidence session, I think, was a really good one, because I think there's still power there for the court system to be able to have hearings in person if that's appropriate for all parties. So based on that, you've actually probably already answered in your opening statement and to my colleague Jamie Green there, the main thrust of my question. But I suppose what I want to know is the legislation that's been proposed to us just now, how much is that needed in order to allow us to move to that more remote system that allows us to protect vulnerable witnesses, particularly in the most high-profile cases of domestic abuse, etc., as we've already heard. Do you feel that, you know, the Parliament needs to pass this legislation to help us to move to that objective?
I think if we're still talking about the virtual trials, and this won't move things forward, it'll continue the basis on which we currently are able to do that with the default positions, which have been mentioned already. But separately, as I've mentioned, we would want to look at whether other legislative vehicles would allow us to do that once we have the consultations and the work with partners. And just to go back to your point, so say if you have a very vulnerable witness, first of all, it's not for me to intrude on how a defence representative prepares a witness, obviously, but I'm not dismissing what they say when they say they need to have that experience of talking directly to their client. But similarly for the client, they would want to draw certain confidence from their legal representative, and maybe a personal meeting is crucial to that. But just to say that this, what we are seeking to do today, is to extend the time frame within which we can do what we currently do within a virtual trials. And any further or permanent extension of that would come through other means after a due process of consultation. So there's no real change to, if that was the question you're asking.
Yeah, thanks a lot. The panel that was in before you, we heard quite strong support for the legislation from the two witnesses, from both the
Crown Prosecution Service and the courts. And the question that I put to them was, did they feel that, you know, the progress that they'd started to make? And I think, you know, as I'm sure Katie Clark will go into, I'll try not to step on her toes, you know, perhaps, you know, there wasn't as many virtual trials as we'd expected through the pandemic, but there's a clear desire to still move in that direction. And certainly the two witnesses that we heard felt that they feel that the legislation is needed in order to allow us to continue to move in that direction. So I guess that it was a follow-up question to theirs, but I think you have answered it well.
Just to add, though, that of course, and I've said that we want to try and examine the means by which we can get that increased evidence base, and I think it was Mr Green that asked about pilots and so on. As well as the Crown Office and the Court Service, we would have to have the Judiciary, Lord President in particular, in advance of any legislation, be in support of that. He has a very, if I do say so, a keen interest in seeing innovation happen, especially in relation to digital technology. So I'm confident we'd have his eagerness to help with that, but it would be, he would have to permit further either extension of the current basis of the trials or any pilot that might take place beyond what's been done already. But you can see that in the report from Sheriff Principal Pyle as well. There's an eagerness there to examine that, and we'd certainly be responsive to that.
I'll bring in Katie Clark and then Russell.
A short question, really. Picking up on the comment that it's for the judiciary to decide, could you just really confirm that if the government felt that virtual trials at summary level were successful, that you would come back with primary legislation if you wished that to be a permanent change?
Yeah, I think I said that already. Yeah. It wouldn't be through this process, which was for the pandemic, but yes, of course, if we, and we're actively involved in that dialogue just now with the judiciary as well. There are two routes. One is a practice note from the judiciary, but that would only take it so far. I think it's fair to say the preference of the judiciary would be for primary legislation.
Thank you.
And Russell?
Thank you. The last budget, the Scottish Court and Tribunal Service received £10 million less than they requested. Is that consistent with the urgency that the backlog requires?
Yes, we had a number of discussions. I think it's probably true that a number of different parties across government and perhaps even across society received less than they would have hoped for from the budget. That's the nature of the budget and the fact the cut in the budget which we've had. We've now had about 10 years of austerity, but there are still, and that builds up pressures over time, of course it does, which we've tried to respond to. But no, we worked very closely with the Court Service on the budget. And the Crown Office separately negotiate their budget with the Finance Secretary as well, so that's for them to answer in relation to that. But I'm confident, given the budget and the constrained means which we have, is the one sufficient to allow the Court Service to do what they intend to do, not least in relation to the backlog.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much. Okay, thanks very much. We'll just now, I'm just watching the time, we'll just now move on to some questioning around time limits, and then we'll move on to, we'll come back to early release. So hand back to Jamie Green.
Okay, thank you. I will do it in that order then. Give me a second. I was expecting to be asking questions about early release.
You don't have to at all.
I haven't got a huge amount to ask about time limits, other than I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary has already listened to some of the concerns that have been raised about it. I think I reiterated in the last session the need for extending time limits to ensure that cases don't expire, time out in any way. No one wants to see that. But there has been concerns raised about the length of time and the possibility that these may be a permanent feature rather than a temporary one because of the nature of the backlog. Do you have any views on why you may need a long-term power to extend the time limits, given that the limits proposed go way beyond anything ever experienced in the Scottish legal system and, in some cases, beyond international norms, standards or even laws?
I think, first of all, I think this is one of the most serious powers that we're looking to extend. And I wouldn't have just come to that conclusion myself. We've had very strong representations from justice partners that this is necessary just now for the situation that we find ourselves in relation to the pandemic. And of course, it has certain safety valves within. Anybody held for longer than normally would be the case on remand has the ability to challenge that, as do others. So, no, we would not want to extend this beyond it being absolutely necessary. It's these are fundamental questions about people's right to liberty. I acknowledge that. So we think it's absolutely necessary just now. I mean, that's in reference to people on remand, but various other time limits, some of which, of course, go the other way. So allowing people longer if they are, say, due to appear in court, but can't because they've contracted COVID. And I think yesterday we saw 11,500 people in Scotland contracted COVID, so it's not a theoretical possibility. So it is about trying to make sure that we can make the justice system work and that we can ensure people's safety. So I suppose in summary, I would say that we recognise these are very substantial, profound powers, and we wouldn't want to have them for any longer than is necessary. But we continue to believe not least based on the representations that we've received from those in the justice system that they are necessary. And not least, I would say, and it would be for her to answer from the Lord Advocate, who is obviously the person that is charged with guaranteeing people's rights, but she believes this is also necessary. I don't know if any officials want to say any more about that.
I think as the previous evidence session said, it's more about providing more time to spend on cases than on procedural matters, and that's a key part of this. And as Cabinet Secretary outlined, they're not there for a permanent basis. It's a longer extension for as long as they're required around the backlog. Mm.
So you deem it a proportionate power to request. When will this power expire? Is that also in the sunset clause of 2025?
Yes, they're all based around that. So that annual review gives us that if you like, a stocktake point to assess and an evidence back what that's delivered and why they may be required on that point or not.
Okay. Not only the annual review, even in advance of an annual milestone, it's possible for the government to and for the committee to request, if you think the situation has changed sufficiently, to request that those powers are no longer held.
Yeah, I guess the general commentary is that on the 21st of March, virtually most, if not all, COVID-related emergency measures will be relaxed in Scotland. Therefore, why do ministers need another 2 and a bit years of powers to extend time limits other than simply as a result of the backlog? So therefore, it's not necessarily direct health emergency-related power to hold. It's one that's simply a means to an end to clear the backlog and ensure cases don't time out, which I think is a fair criticism.
I'm not sure I do wholly agree with that. I think the backlog is a direct consequence of the pandemic and is therefore something that we can legitimately try to address through these powers. I've said before that in relation to virtual courts, they would have a beneficial impact, obviously, in the backlog, but it's not principally for that reason that you'd want to pursue them. But I think in relation to this, these powers are taken to address the COVID situation, and that includes the backlog, and I think it's legitimate to do that.
OK, thank you for that. On the early release issue, I'm pleased to be able to come back and ask a question. Thank you, Convener. So, how many people exactly have been released earlier than the current statutory automatic early release details? And what was the nature of their term in prison, length of sentence, average, for example, what type of offences would they have been in prison for? If, as we heard from one of the other panel members, they tended to be people serving 18 months or less, then presumably they would have been early released at 9 months anyway. So how much did they actually serve of their sentence before they were early released? That's perhaps the second part of my question.
Yeah, well, that would obviously vary from prisoner to prisoner, but I would ask Jenna if she's able to give the figures that have been mentioned. I'm sure they've been reported to Parliament previously, but I don't know if you've got them to hand, Jennifer.
Thank you. So we've used this power once, as you know, in May 2020, and that released 348 prisoners. I can quickly go through who that did and didn't cover, if that's of use to you.
Perhaps for the benefit of time, you could write to the committee in advance of our preparation of the Stage 1 report. We can analyse it. That's helpful. Thank you. And going back to the answer previously given around reoffending, I get the impression that from anyone that there was an expectation that a cohort of them would reoffend anyway due to the nature of the length of their sentence or the fact that they had not been in prison long enough to be rehabilitated, for want of a better word. In that case, knowing there were such high rates of reoffending in that cohort of short-term prisoners, why would they have been released early? I'll ask the Cabinet Secretary first.
I don't say we had an expectation, but I'm saying if you look now at the incidence of reoffending, I think it turned out to be around 40% of those prisoners, and that wasn't all reoffending, that was people going back to custody. And as I mentioned, sometimes that will be for reasons other than reoffending. The point I made was that if you take the short sentences, the average reoffending can be between 50 and 60%. So the fact there was 40%, it's not an expectation that people reoffend, but it's perhaps not surprising that level of reoffending. And I think that in itself is an argument for more effective community justice disposals, which allow us to deal with that, because we know from the evidence that we have, that reduces the likelihood of reoffending. And it maybe would have been useful to have had the reminder of the categories of prisoners who were released, how close they were to the end of their sentence, how long the sentence was. I think it's 18 months or less sentence. But yes, it is the case that people who've been released from prison sometimes reoffend, and that's a higher incidence when it's people in short sentences. Yeah. And it's a legitimate point to say if prison service has the time to deal with somebody who has offended over a greater period, the prison service would not have been expecting when these people were sentenced that they're going to have an early release. That happened because of the pandemic.
That doesn't answer the question. The question is, knowing there is such a high rate of reoffending, why on earth would it have been a sensible decision to release these people early, even earlier than automatic early release, which already debatable is at 50% of their sentence?
Well, if the question is why did you release these prisoners, then we did that because of the pandemic, and the consequences of not doing it we deemed to be unacceptable in terms of the constraints on our prisons because of COVID, the constraints on prisoners because of COVID, and the public safety of prisoners, prison officers, prison staff and people visiting prisons. That's why we did this.
What about the public safety of the public rather than the public safety of the prisoners? Well, is that not taken into account?
Of course. That's why Parliament debated it and I think agreed it. I think it may have been unanimously, I'm not sure, but that's. I think it's true to say if what the member says you're balancing, as COVID has made governments and others do, you're balancing harms. And that's what Parliament decided that was a better option to take.
So why do you need the power moving forward?
Because the same situation could arise again in relation to COVID, and we think that's only really justifiable up to 2025 if we're talking about COVID. There's a separate question about why you'd want to have that power on a permanent basis, which obviously could be addressed to the UK government as well. I'd imagine their response would be you can't always anticipate whether it's a public health emergency or some other reason. So I'd imagine there'd be different answers in relation to that. But the reason that we want it for this purpose is because we don't yet know the root path of COVID or its variants.
Thank you, Convener.
Very much. We're just about there. I think I'll bring in Russell Finlay to ask some final question, a question to pick up on this topic, and then we'll cover off fiscal fines. So
yes, it's just picking up on the reoffending of those who were released early. We know it's about 40%. I think you said in your answer to Jamie Green that the regular reoffending rate is about 50 to 60%. But Scottish Government figures from 2018-2019 show that reoffending rate within a year to be just under 30%. So if indeed that's correct, the reoffending rate for those released earlier is significantly higher. I'm just wondering if you can clarify where the 50-60% might have come from, if that relates to a different cohort or just explain those discrepancies.
Yeah, I might be asking Jennifer to come in, but I don't know whether part of the explanation for the difference between 30% is whether that includes all releases from prison. I don't know the detail of it. I haven't seen that, but it might be useful to hear from Jennifer whether I'm getting the 40, 50, 60, and even the 30%, whether those are correct.
Yeah, of course. So the 60% is those prisoners serving 3 months or less, the 61%. And the 53% is those who serve 3 to 6 months. And just to pick up quickly on a point that both yourself and Mr Green have made, public safety was a key consideration when we determined who would be released. So that was why there are particular statutory exclusions on the face of the bill, which are for more serious offences. And within the regulations, it was those serving 18 months or less and those who were within 90 days of their release. And the reason that 18 months or less was selected is obviously the longer sentence you are serving, the more serious your offending is likely to be. And we also worked closely with the victims' organisations, and as a result of their feedback, those individuals serving either as an aggravation or as an offence under the Domestic Abuse Act, anyone who was convicted of a domestic abuse offence or had a non-harassment order was also excluded. The public safety was a key consideration in determining who would be released. And also, as the Cabinet Secretary said, the reason this was needed was because at the time there was particular pressure within the prison system, and there was a need to have that capacity within the system to enable people to shield and to have single cell capacity. So it was not a decision that was taken lightly, and there was really careful consideration around public safety considerations.
Thank you. And finally, in respect of early release, the prison service told us that none of the prisoners released early were tested for COVID, and this was done to protect the public from COVID. If it were to happen again, would that change?
I think the prison release happened, I think, just before I'd taken up office, and one of the first things I had to do on coming into office was to read through voluminous tracts about public health and the framework which had to be applied to prisons. So I think it's true to say that prisons will have learnt from that, and they've heard that question, and it's not the first time it's been asked, so I'm sure we'll want to give that some further thought. But I think there were good reasons in some cases for not testing prisoners, but of course you want to learn each time you do something from previous experience.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you very much. I don't think there are any more questions, so in that case I'll just bring this part of the meeting to a close, and thank you very much indeed to all our witnesses for attending, and we'll just take a very short break in order to change over our witnesses. Thank you. Thank you very much and welcome back, everybody. The next agenda item is consideration of evidence on a negative instrument, the Prisoners, the Prisons and Young Offenders Institutions Coronavirus Scotland Amendment Rules of 2022. And I welcome to the meeting Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans, and Jamie McQueen from the Scottish Government Legal Directorate, and officials attending online today. We've just got Alistair Purdy, Director of Operations of the Scottish Prison Service, and I refer members to Papers 3 and 4. And I'd like to invite the Cabinet Secretary to make some brief opening remarks.
Thank you, Convener. I will take, if I can, just a wee bit of time just to lay out some of the provisions here, just it might make it easier for questions. The Prisons and Young Offenders Institutions Coronavirus Scotland Amendment Rules 2022 SSI extends the application of certain modifications made to the prison rules in response to the pandemic by the Prisons and Young Offenders Institutions Scotland Amendment Rules 2020 for a further 6 months to the 30th of September 2022. And when I appeared before the committee in September about these powers, I spoke of the need to ensure that the prison service was able to take all necessary measures as we approached another winter during this pandemic. Of course, neither committee members nor I could have predicted the rapid emergence of the Omicron variant only a few months later. That's left no doubt that it remains the case that the government must ensure the prison service can deploy precautionary and protective measures as necessary in response to this ongoing and unpredictable pandemic. It's therefore essential to extend the flexibility afforded by the previous rule amendments in order to ensure we can keep those living, visiting and working in our prisons safe. I didn't remind the committee that prisons are complex settings with a significant number of vulnerable people. While the current rule amendments have been enforced, the Omicron variant has brought peaks of around 150 cases to the prison estate in January and staff absence rates of 9%. We continue to see COVID cases across the prison estate, and as at Friday the 4th of March last week, there were 126 positive cases among 11 prisons. Consistent with the current SSI in force, the powers being extended to the 30th of September are the powers that allow governors to suspend or restrict, if necessary and proportionate, in-person visits, purposeful activity and recreation in response to local outbreaks, the powers which provide for extended timescales in relation to the isolation of large groups of individuals, so governors and local NHS partners have the means to comply with Public Health Scotland and Scottish Government advice. And this includes isolation of those who are symptomatic or who have been in close contact with a person who is symptomatic, those who are identified as close contacts of a person who is symptomatic, or those who are new admissions where that may prevent a COVID-19 risk. The ability for governors to extend the period of prisoners on home leave for up to 14 days from the normal 7 days where prisoners advise they or that someone in their home has coronavirus or has developed symptoms of coronavirus. In advance of laying the SSI, members will be aware that the Prison Service wrote to stakeholders to seek views on the extension of these powers, and those responses have been published on the SPS website. I am aware that stakeholders and members have concerns regarding the impact on human rights and that there have been recent calls for transparency in the reporting of why and how frequently the powers are being used in the estate. As I reiterated in September, these powers are being and will only be used as precautionary measures and as a proportionate and necessary response to localised outbreaks in the prison estate. Decisions on their use will remain subject to multi-agency decision-making and public health advice, and remain subject to independent scrutiny by HM Chief Inspector of Prisons for Scotland. Despite the vulnerability of those in prison to the highly transmissible Omicron, the powers have not impacted on the vast majority of the prison population since October, and the prison service is providing as full a regime as possible. The Inspector of Prisons, in her summary report of the COVID pandemic emergency liaison visit report published in January, has commented on the proportionate way in which restrictions have been applied. She says, the overwhelming impression was of a calm and orderly atmosphere in prisons and regimes that were restricted but safe. It was also clear that prisons were working hard to provide more opportunities and reduce restrictions wherever possible. I'm aware that Theresa Medhurst wrote to the committee last week with a collation of high-level information on the use of the current powers since October 2021 to February 22, and I'm sure that members found that helpful. It set out the proportionate use of the powers in 7 prisons for a variety of reasons in response to local outbreaks. Ms. Medhurst has helpfully committed to the provision of further high-level updates to the committee on use of the powers as requested. And lastly, with regard to human rights,
I should make clear that governors are already under a legal duty to act compatibly with human rights in the discharge of their functions, and they can only use these powers where it's necessary and proportionate to do so. It's the SPS position that these amendments have a positive impact on protecting human rights. In terms of Articles 2 and 3, these rule changes are designed to help SPS prevent and reduce the risks of the virus spreading within the estate. And without the availability of these measures, the Article 3 rights of the prison population could be engaged. SPS also recognised the potential to engage the Article 8 rights of prisoners when utilised. However, it's their view that the powers can and are being applied in a proportionate way to have the least impact possible upon prisoners' Article 8 rights, and thus they don't breach those rights. So to conclude, the draft instrument provides for precautionary powers essential to the Scottish Prison Service's continuing response to all unknown eventualities of this pandemic, whether nationally or locally. The emergence of this winter's new variant has shown we cannot be complacent given the vulnerability of the prison setting to coronavirus. I would just say that in relation to the assurances given that this is being applied in a proportionate way, I think the effect of this and other measures is demonstrated by the much lower levels of COVID incidence than certainly many of us feared at the start of the pandemic. And with that, happy to answer any questions, Convener.
Thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary. That's very helpful. I think what we'll do is go round the room, but I'll kick off questions, if I may, just with a general opening question around the sort of justification for the six-month extension. So given the removal of restrictions in most other areas and the fact that things are opening up, and that is in the context of we know that there are still cases, and you mentioned earlier on the kind of numbers that we've been seeing just in the last week or so, so that the pandemic is very much still with us. But I'm just wondering if the proposal to extend the provision is slightly out of sync with the, you know, what is happening in other areas, and whether or not this reflects the sort of Scottish Government's current guidance around coronavirus and restrictions.
I would be asking Alistair to come in on this as well, but it's certainly true to say, I think I'd mentioned in the previous evidence session, that we applied additional guidance beyond the Scottish Government guidance through Public Health Scotland and others, a huge number of different provisions of guidance. So that was done in recognition of the particular circumstances that prisons are. They're by necessity confined spaces. So I think, and again, if I remember back to the pandemic, not that I was in government at the time, but I think everybody was very fearful of what might happen in prisons because of that. So they will have their own necessity for taking action, which might not be always completely aligned with the general population, which is able to take other measures. So that's the general rationale for it, Convener.
Thanks very much. Can I just ask a follow-up question around the actual process of sort of assessment in terms of where a governor or the decision-making that a governor and others makes? And we know that the decisions around imposing this particular provision are very much sort of public health-based, but I'm just interested in the actual process and how it is informed and the actual, can maybe some of the detail of that risk assessment process?
Well, I would say that it's best to hear from Alistair, who will be familiar with that process within the SPS, but there are some things which come back to government, so some restrictions which might be applied, if they seek to extend them, will come back to government for approval for that. But as to the internal processes, perhaps if Alistair could answer.
Yeah, thanks, Cabinet Secretary, and thanks, Convener. Yeah, I mean, the instances where the precautionary measures are applied for short-term measures always come through our incident management teams, and our public health colleagues will advise us on that. So the decision-making point starts there between the local multi-agency team there, the Governor, and the risk assessment that's made to try and put a stop or put a fire break in towards the outbreak. That will then look at what's required within the local outbreak in the establishment, and there will be certain measures that will be proposed by our public health colleagues to stem that flow and the outbreak. That's the decision making. The Governor will then look at that, look at the risks, look at the proportionate impact it would have Can it be localised to one area? Can it be contained to a wing? Can it be contained to certain specific areas? And then make that dynamic risk assessment based on public health advice. They will then touch base in with ourselves and Prisons Directorate, talk through what the potential restrictions could be and the likely timescales that they will take effect from, and then the decision will be made there by the Governor. The Governor is also tuned into our National Coronavirus Response Group, who have active information and up-to-date evidence from across the country and public health colleagues about the likely impact that they could have on their establishment. So based on that, they will make their decision. We will then keep it actively under review between the Governor and centrally SPS for how long that could last and with our public health colleagues. And it's stopped as soon as it's the proportionality is not required, we stop it.
Thanks very much, Mr. Purdy. That's very helpful. Just going to hand straight over to Russell and we'll just work our way around the room.
Okay, thank you. The Inspector of Prisons has raised a concern about a lack of communication from the SPS in respect of the use of these powers and the lack of an ability to properly externally monitor the decision-making and the implications of what happens. Is that something that can be improved upon? And I suppose that's a question first and foremost from Mr. Purdy.
I say first of all that I read out the testimony from the inspector, which was extremely positive about the prison services applying these regulations, and of course it should be the case that she should have the information that she requires, but I don't know if Ansel, you want to add to that.
Yeah, thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you, Mr. Russell. We have regular updates with Her Majesty's Inspector following any outbreak, and we're always open to learning, as you would be, because throughout the pandemic, lessons learned has been something that we've tried to integrate into all our practices so we minimise the impact on our population. But we have open meetings monthly with Her Majesty's Inspector's team, and they have regular inspections day-to-day by their independent prison monitors. So we're open to learning any ways that we could improve on that.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Fulton?
Convener, I've not got any specific questions that haven't already been addressed by the Cabinet Secretary. I mean, it's a sort of thought, if you like, rather than a question. It's not obviously not ideal to be in a situation where we're looking to extend these things, but I think we're all in the same boat there, and you know we're living in really difficult times, and I think, as you already highlighted at the start, the pandemic is still with us in certain areas where people are living closer together, such as prisons. We still need to err on the side of caution. So I've got no specific questions.
Thanks very much. Jamie, would you like to come in?
Or? Yes, thank you. Just some fact-checking questions. First, what is the current prison population in Scotland? I know it changes on a day-by-day basis, but the latest snapshot, and either as a number or percentage, what percentage of those inmates currently have COVID? Because we know the figures for wider society. Do we know the figures for the prison population?
I think I mentioned the figures at least from the 4th of March in the opening statement, but you can check back and confirm that. And I'll take my stab at the prison population. The latest figure I saw was around 7,502 or 3, but happy to be corrected on that. I think if I can just check my statement, I'll tell you exactly what the numbers that are currently have COVID, or unless you've got that right to hand.
I don't know. It's not a rhetoric question. I don't know the answer. I'm sorry I missed
it. I meant Alistair, if you had it right to hand, but I have it here. I read it out earlier on. So.
Okay.
I do, Cabinet Secretary, if it's helpful. It's actually increased from the briefing that you had. It was 126. It's now 159 today, yesterday. So it's actually increased this week again. So, and you're absolutely right, the population has sat just roughly 7,500 and just over for the last month.
OK, I'll maybe continue then with Mr. Purdy. He's got all the facts. An apologies to the Cabinet Secretary for not jotting it down, but I'm glad to get an updated number. And how do you think that compares relative to wider society? Are you finding that you're able to contain cases more easily in a prison environment, or is it simply more difficult due to the nature of the state? And what effect has any relaxation on some of the restrictions that were needed during the temporary COVID measures, such as visitation or people being out on license or temporary release. What effect has any relaxation had on the relativity of the case rate versus the population to say, for example, when restrictions were in place? Are we seeing a marked proportionate increase in the positivity rate as a result of relaxation or not?
Maybe just, Mr. Green, just for some context as well, through the Public Health Scotland, the prison's advice is actually is a stepped-up approach from what the community restrictions would be. So we've kept in many of the restrictions and measures because of the high-risk nature of the environment. So, for example, distancing, isolation, hygiene, testing has been of a higher standard or proportion than the population. So we have maintained that, and that's been in an attempt to try and restrict the transient population from community back into custody as well, because that is a key risk area for us as well. So we've maintained many of those procedures in an attempt to do that, and we continue to do that. It still poses, to answer your question, it still poses significant risk because of that transient population through the criminal justice system back into community and back into prisons. We have seen it in line with the community in terms of the variants, in terms of the peaks and the troughs have been largely in line with the public. Omicron and the previous Kent variant and the variant before that back to March 2020.
That's very helpful, and your analysis of the differences is helpful as well. I guess my other question is more a wider one, maybe to the Cabinet Secretary, and that's that if we as a society are, to use the phrase, learning to live with COVID, in the sense that yesterday, as you said, there were 11,000 cases, but at the same time, we're also heading in a path of moving away from restrictions to the point where we hope that life is as back to normal as it can be, but COVID will still be around. That doesn't seem to be the case in the prison environment, where they are maintaining higher levels of restrictions relative to wider society. So I guess the question is, why is that a proportionate use of temporary powers if it is no longer a temporary emergency and simply a long-term pandemic, or indeed endemic, situation that we're living with in society?
I think really straightforward reason that there are boundaries, literally boundaries, which apply to the prison state, which don't apply to wider society. I think it's true to say that no society caught up with the pandemic would have had their public estate, whether schools, hospitals, prisons, as they would like it to be for a pandemic in terms of ventilation and so on as well. And that will be no less true of the prison service. Some of the prison, despite the substantial modernisation that's taken place over the last 15 or 20 years, is still, some of it's still Victorian. So that's a constraint that they cannot get past in the same way the society can do it, the wider society. We can all do things, change our behaviours, change where we go, in a way that prisoners and prison officers cannot do. So that's why they have a higher level, and the consequences of one person getting it can be a much faster transmission within an enclosed environment such as a prison. So that's the main, I don't know if you want to add to that, Alistair, but that's the main constraint that I see. And that's why we had, right through the pandemic, a different standard, as Alistair said, that we required prisons to meet. And I have to say, I think it's been really successful. And also, just if I can, whilst Alistair's on, to acknowledge the work and the pressures that the prison service have been under during all this as well.
Can't say that. All I would add to that is it's the balance of the four harms, as we know, that we've been trying to do to try and provide people with that meaningful regime and activity and try and address offending behaviour whilst allowing people to be free as possible, but within a constricted environment where we realise that households are much bigger than they are in the community and the spread is significant. So it's balancing the harms as well, and making sure that safety of everybody, as the Cabinet Secretary has said, who lives, works or visits the prisons, is our paramount kind of at the front of their minds.
Thank you. And just one last one is, will there be any improvement in the transparency around the frequency or impact of powers as they're used on a based case-by-case basis, given that they are used in different ways in different establishments. One of the HMIP and other stakeholders who've written to us expressed concern around was the issue of clarity and transparency over how and when the powers were used, and therefore moving forward, if there remain features and powers that remain, if that will be improved for the benefit, particularly of the families of those who are in prison.
I think that's an entirely reasonable request. I think it's maybe a bit distinct from what Mr. Finlay raised in terms of the inspectorate not having the information that she was looking for. So from my point of view, I'm happy to see that that does happen. I think obviously when lockdowns happened very unexpectedly, that was probably more difficult to achieve, but there should be no reason now for not having the maximum possible transparency, given the fact that it is prisoners, but their rights are being, you know, if you like, affected by this. So I think that transparency is legitimate, and certainly I'll do what I can, and I'm sure the SBS will as well, to make sure we have that.
Thank you.
Katie, bring you in now.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. You spoke about the human rights considerations, and I presume in particular you'd be thinking about Article 3 and whether these requirements amount to inhumane and degrading treatment. Could you perhaps outline what you feel you could do in your role to make sure that there is proportionate action taken by the Scottish Prison Service and governors in particular, and how more resources could be put in, both in terms of the transparency issues that Jamie Green was spoken about, because the Scottish Prison Service did speak about systems issues, but also so that there is an awareness in prisons of the importance of these human rights considerations.
I believe that they are. They figure in the minds, you know, including individual prison officers, not just governors, about the rights that prisoners have. But you've kind of mentioned some of the assurances that we have around that. So you have the inspector who's able to challenge where she believes that prisoners' rights are not being observed. You have, as Jamie Green has asked for, the assurance around transparency, making sure that when it's done, it's logged. People know when it's done and why it's been done and when it finishes and the reasons why it's finished. And beyond that, I think it's also true to say that we can, and I'm sure Alistair could do it more effectively than I could, although it's Jamie that's the expert on the interplay between different rights. There's different things which the prison service has done, tried to mitigate the impact of that. So in cell telephony, for example, has been a big boon to prisoners, not without its issues, of course. But so I think that shows that there has been a recognition that these are extraordinary measures which are taken, which do impact on prisoners' rights, and we've tried to make sure that's been mitigated. But there are any number, I think, of checks on that. And if we can increase that by responding to what Jamie Green said in terms of transparency, then we should do that. I think those are the reassurances that I would give. Mm-hmm. It might be worth hearing from Jamie, mm-hmm. who's the expert on the interplay, like yourself, I'm sure, on the rights affected.
Well, I think one of the things there as well to add is the Scottish Government does have guidance that's produced with Public Health Scotland and SPS as well around sort of the management of COVID in prisons as well. And in terms of the Article 3, there's all of the human rights aspects of this, there are tensions between them, obviously, because in terms of the prisoners' access to meaningful activities and or purposeful activities, rather, and also protecting them from the virus sort of ripping through the prisons in a kind of less controlled way anyway. And so those balances are always have to be in the mind of the decision maker, including governors, because they are bound to act compatibly with the European Convention on Human Rights.
Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what his understanding is how, in terms of how the prisons differentiate between different types of prisoners? So, for example, during COVID, children in prison have been subject to the same measures to combat virus infection as adults. What's his understanding in terms of how the prisons balance those rights and look at individuals, and particularly individuals who may be more vulnerable?
I think Before going to the specific example you raised about children or under 18s, in general terms, you'll know, and I know the committee has visited prison, so you'll know this firsthand, especially from having been to Sockton Prison, that there is a big balancing act to be done, not just between vulnerable prisoners of different kinds, but also between sometimes competing serious organised crime groups as well. Mm-hmm. So the prison mm-hmm. service is very good at doing that. It's not without its tensions and its problems, of course. So they've done that, and that will include looking after the rights, the safety and the health of vulnerable prisoners. In relation to under-18s, of course, we've got a much, much smaller number of those now. I think we're down to about 14 from perhaps 200-plus in 2006, but they still are, and they are put in prison by mm-hmm. The courts. That's who decides mm-hmm. that they go there, rather than to another alternative provision. And it's my understanding, and perhaps it's best to hear from Alistair, is that they, as you said, will have the same restrictions, although they're based in Pullmont, which is not currently full, in fact, far from it. So maybe that provides some more latitude, but maybe it's mm-hmm. good to hear from Alistair on that.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Yeah, they are. There's a very small cohort of held in Pullmont, and the capacity in Pullmont helps us to allow to manage our virus outbreak there more effectively, so we don't have to impose the restrictions or precautionary measures as we would in other establishments. But we do, because the committee will know that the virus does not discriminate. It's actually, it has gone through our whole population, and it has impacted on the young people in our custody in Pullmont, simply because of the fact that they are open most of the time. We have either had an outbreak, and that then spreads to the, at the time there was 16 or 17 of them, it spread to them all. But the capacity we have in Pullmont allows us to manage that outbreak more effectively. And hopefully the high-level information that Ms. Theresa Messer's provided to the committee in her letter of the 3rd of March will kind of outline that Pullmont has not been one of the establishments or the young people that have had significant impact from the virus, but we're always alert to putting the same protective measures in for the young people as any other classification of prisoners across the estate.
Thank you. And we've been given information as to how the powers have been used since October 2021. And as the Cabinet Secretary knows, the buck stops with him. And I just wanted to ask, to what extent is he advised of steps that have been taken on a regular basis, so he's able to give that political oversight? So if that he had concerns in terms of how the legislation was being implemented, he was able to take action or express those concerns?
Yeah, it's a very regular update which we get, which goes down to individual prison level, which gives, at least during the, if you like, the worst of the pandemic, the level of increases in individual prisons, the movement between wings when the wings got to be isolated. It also talks, the updates I get talk about new prisoners coming in. Mm-hmm. It gives some background on where they think the COVID might have started. If it's somebody new coming in, it gives details on the level of prisoners who have been vaccinated either once, twice or three times. And also it gives levels in terms of testing. Also gives levels in terms of testing for prison staff as well. So pretty detailed and regular accounts. I can't think of a time, I've had lots of questions to ask, and it features into other systems which the government has in place generally for the management of the pandemic, but I can't think of any, apart from asking for more information, I've had to intervene to, if you like, impose a political kind of mm-hmm. Steer on it.
Sure. But when these powers are used, you are informed that they have been used in a particular establishment?
Well, whether it's the case in every single one, every single power, no. But if there's a movement, say, for example, for a wing to have been closed down or mm-hmm. people to have been isolated in that way, or whether there's been things like a move to double shifting, which means there's more purposeful activity that can take place, I'm advised of those mm-hmm. things, yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Before I move on to Rona, I'll bring Rona in just as our final questions. Can I just pick up on the, you're speaking there about self-isolation and some of the measures that are required to respond to that. I'm aware that Scottish Prison Service statistics from the 8th of this month, a couple of days ago, said that there's around about 1,140 prisoners self-isolating at the moment, which in the context of the overall prison population seems quite a high number. I'm just wondering if that presents additional challenges in terms of the day-to-day running of prisons. I don't know if that's maybe something that Mr. Purdy might pick up.
Yeah, probably Alistair's best place, but just to say about that number, which Alistair will be able to confirm or otherwise, of course that includes quite a high level of remand prisoners for reasons that we're all aware of, and also the moving in and out of prison. So the prison service is more susceptible, but it's not at all immune from the wider increase that we've seen, certainly over the last week or so, but Alistair would have more detail on that.
Yeah. Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Yeah, Kavina, that number is correct in terms of those isolating. And that's simply as a result of the households being larger and its precautionary measures for to make sure that anybody who is a close contact, anybody who's symptomatic or asymptomatic in there, as isolated for as short a period as possible so that we can keep the households safe. It does cause problems as well, because it clearly restricts someone's individual's activity within the prison on that day or for a number of days until we can make sure that they're safe and that the virus has been cleared or the area is as safe as it can be. So it does cause operational difficulties in terms of that number. Our public health guidance for prisons, as I mentioned before, places again a burden on us in terms of our isolation, different from the community as it is just now, simply because it's a high-risk residential area. And that's to really protect the Article 3 that we talked about earlier, it's people's health, safety and humane treatment. So we do have high isolation numbers just now.
Thanks very much. That's very helpful, Mr. Purdy. I'll just bring in Rona just to
thank
ask
you.
Some final
yeah,
questions.
Thanks, Convener. My question is very much in the same line as Katie, and the Cabinet Secretary has answered most. It's about purposeful activity and exercise. And the briefing we got from Theresa Medhurst shows the very different the differences between the prison estate and, you know, and reading the notes, it seems to be mainly staff related and staff absences that are a major factor in this. So I wonder if Mr. Purdy could maybe just confirm that to go on the record, and also to ask, was there ever any thought given to perhaps sort of drafting in retired prison officers to cover temporarily in situations so that the, you know, more activity could be given?
Yeah. Thank you. It is, and you will see from the outlined high level that it has been acute numbers of staff who were off at peak times, specifically during the Omicron as well. We have transferred staff from other establishments who are not experiencing outbreaks to other establishments. The risk in that is that we may well be exporting the virus from one establishment back into the family home or into the community. So we have done that on several occasions, and we continue to use that as one of our kind of contingency plans to keep establishments functioning so we don't have to take the precautionary measures and set aside purposeful activity or indeed visits that we know that are so important to the rehabilitative programme for our people in our custody and families.
Thank you. That's fine. Thank you
very much. Okay, thank you very much, everybody. That brings this part of the meeting to a close. Again, thank you to the witnesses for attending, and we'll just have a very short break to allow for a changeover of officials. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, everybody. So our final item of business this morning is consideration of the service and case management system used by social work and prison staff to assess risk management in the justice system. And thank you to the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans for remaining for this agenda item. And I also welcome to the meeting Kat Dalrymple, Deputy Director, Community Justice of the Scottish Government. And I refer members to Paper 5. So in light of the time available, I'd like to move straight on to questions. And I want to just ask members if they would like to indicate if they'd like to ask a question. Take Russell first and then Jamie.
Thank you very much. Now, Cabinet Secretary, I understand that one of your responsibilities is to consider first grant temporary release applications for those serving life sentences. It's a two-pronged question, and the first part is how many of these have you had to consider in your tenure? And the second part is how many of these were based on the incorrect risk assessment due to this problem?
Yeah, I should say, I think I had mentioned in response to a similar question during the statement last week, I hope to be able to give a reassuring response to Mr. Finlay, and I should say I have not granted any first grant of temporary release. However, it's also true to say that for a number of years now, that function has been carried out by the Minister and the Justice portfolio, so in this case, by the Minister for Community Safety. And having carried out a reconciliation of the SPS system with the identified affected cases, eight cases where first grant of temporary release have been granted were found. These have all been looked at again, and I'm able to confirm there are no immediate or concerning public protection risks highlighted, although these eight cases will be further reviewed by the Risk Review Group, which I mentioned last week in a statement to provide further assurance.
Thank you. I've got another question, if that's okay. Yes. Yep. Now, presumably, some prisoners will believe that they may have suffered a detriment by being kept in prison longer than the risk assessment might have suggested they should. Are you anticipating any form of legal challenge from prisoners, given how litigious they can sometimes be?
Well, if there was to be a legal challenge, it'd be for others to take that decision. But I think the important thing from my point of view and from the Justice Portfolio's point of view is to make sure that we can identify that if that has been the case. And that's why I've mentioned previously about the risk review process that we're carrying out. It's quite a lengthy, detailed and technical process. There are different layers to it, but it will be a very thorough process. I don't know whether it's possible to hear from Kat as to how else that's going to be carried out. But as I should also mention, it may well come up. I mentioned last week we had 265 I think cases where that were open, we were concerned, and we've now been able to check just as of today, or certainly yesterday, every single one of those cases, and not one is giving us rise for any issues in terms of public protection. But on the process for other cases where somebody might feel that they've been wrongly assessed, from my understanding and from the different layers of checks which are carried out, that's unlikely to be the case, but it may be a good idea to hear from Kat.
Thank you. If I could start around the first grant of temporary release, I think there was a briefing paper that was provided to members yesterday, which provides significant detail. That's okay. Significant detail around the approach that's taken to those types of decisions, and hopefully that briefing paper will explain to members that in making that decision to apply for that first grant of temporary release, it's a holistic decision from the whole risk management team. And it considers a wide range of factors and available assessments. And it does include the outcome of an LSCMI, but it gives an indication across that whole risk management approach around the manageability of that risk within the community. So as the Cabinet Secretary has indicated, there were 285 live cases that were identified in relation to the risk score and level issue. These have all now been checked, and the last two were confirmed this morning. So social workers have been absolutely amazing in terms of coming back and checking all these cases. And they're confident in those cases that there's no live, immediate or concerning public protection risk. In terms of the wider assurance in relation to the first grant of temporary release cases, those cases will be looked at because they're part of the 1,317 cases that have been passed on to the Risk Review Group that's going to be chaired by the Risk Management Authority. That group met for the first time yesterday, are agreeing a terms of reference. There are a number of different organisations met on that group, 11, I think, different types of organisations right across the justice sector, and they will assess any wider impact in any of these cases. And if you think about the numbers, I mean, it's 1% of the, you know, about 1% of the numbers in the whole system. And that is a good sample exercise in terms of that 1,317. And if there is any impact assessed in terms of their consideration of those cases, then that, I suspect, will inform any future lessons and any future work that would need to be undertaken.
Thank you. I won't hog the questions. I'm sure everyone else wants to.
OK, thank you. I'll bring in Jamie Green and then I'll bring in Fulton McGregor.
Thank you. And can I thank the government for the briefing, albeit 18 pages, trying to digest it overnight wasn't easy, given the technicalities of this. It is a very technical problem. But I just want to just get my head around the bigger picture. We didn't really have a lot of time in the statement last week due to chamber pressures, but this is a great setting to do so. Is 1,317 the absolute maximum amount of cases that any IT glitches that have led to a wrong risk assessment have happened? Is that the absolute maximum? Or is it the case that there could be more, but you simply need to do some more work to find out how many more and how far back the problem goes?
So let me answer this. We've been liaising with our IT provider on the second issue that the Cabinet Secretary highlighted. So we know in the first issue that those cases are the ones that are affected, and we've provided a high level of assurance around those open cases. Initial advice from the IT provider has confirmed the second alcohol and drugs issue, and they've indicated that that's likely to have an overlap with the initial issue. So there's still work ongoing. It suggests that there's a very small number of cases that will be affected, as that error appears to retain information following revisiting of that score. So in order to address that, we are working with the risk review group and professionals in the system to identify what additional level of assurance we are able to provide on the existing cases within the system. Now, that needs to be a really balanced and proportionate approach, because there is no suggestion that, you know, there's a significant number of these cases affected by that issue. We know we've got a high level of assurance already on these cases that are identified as having been confirmed and affected. So we are working with the professionals to work out what is the best way to provide that level of assurance with the existing cases in the system. And we're taking advice from the professional experts in terms of the Risk Management Authority in terms of what that will look like. But I should say that in terms of ongoing case management of individuals within a community, there are a number of different points where a social worker will provide assurance around that LSCMI assessment. So on the fact that there is now a known issue within the system that has been identified, we have been told by all the professionals at any point when a decision is coming up about that individual, so a court decision, you know, preparing a parole dossier, a decision in the prison service around progression, they will obviously assure the LSCMI assessment that individual, that they are confident in that LSCMI assessment, because we know that whilst it, you know, no decision is based on that assessment alone, it is part of that more holistic approach. And then,
I appreciate it's a technical answer to a simple question, but I haven't heard the answer yet, is the problem. So are you saying that, sorry, I'm getting a lot of feedback. Thank you. So just to be absolutely clear, the 1,317 cases, of which 1,032 are closed cases and a couple of hundred are open cases, there is the potential that there may be other cases affected by the IT glitch. And the second question that's linked to the first is, if this goes back prior to the IT centralisation project, which the Cabinet Secretary said may have brought the issue to light in the first place, then that would surely mean that for a number of years, the system was getting it wrong. So what work has been done to identify how many other cases may have been incorrectly risk identified? What do you think the scale of that might be? Are we talking tens, hundreds, thousands? how many prisoners have been released in the last 10 years, I suspect it's a substantial amount. So does the government know how many people may have been wrongly risk assessed prior to release? Not just current cases, but those going right back 10 years.
The answer to that is at this stage, there is no suggestion that there are a significant number of cases affected. What requires to be done is an end-to-end assurance process of that system, going through every different functionality part. I don't want to get too technical and understand, but it is technical. Risk assessment is technical, and the 18-page briefing paper probably demonstrates that. But the LSCMI, there's the first part of the LSCMI, which is a kind of screening tool, and that's used predominantly for court social work reports. And that doesn't have a risk score that's necessarily calculated. That's a kind of 8 question. Predominantly 6 of those are yes, no questions. There are a significant number of those on the system that we know from the identified issue extremely unlikely to be affected. We can't see how they could be affected at this stage. Thereafter, once an individual is being managed and on a community payback order, they're likely to go on to the more detailed LSCMI assessment, and that is where the risk score is tallied up and comes out with a risk level. And that's only part of that detailed assessment, so there is that part. Then there is a secondary part of that, which is considered structured professional judgment that is applied in relation to a number of different questions about that individual's criminogenic needs and about their pattern of offending, about all the wider information. So that's the professional judgment that is applied within that secondary aspect of the risk assessment. So that's not just a score and a level. And then obviously there's a third part of the LSCMI, which if considered necessary by that professional, they go on to do a risk of serious harm assessment. So it's kind of 3 different stages. And what we need to do is assure every single part of that stage through the IT. And we'll be user-led in that as well, in terms of that ongoing review of those types of cases.
But that being said, I think, and I'll need to check the official report, I think the language you used is that there's an expectation that it won't be a large number of cases. But you don't know, I think, is the answer. We don't know if 1,300 is the absolute number that have been affected, or if there are more. If we start delving back into historic archives and looking at on a case-by-case basis, which is a tremendous amount of work, by the way, of people who have been previously released where this system has incorrectly scored them, when will we know exactly, when will that piece of work be finished so that we have a much bigger picture of it?
Yeah, so if I could be clear, there are 2 pieces of work that need to be ongoing. The first is the piece of work under those the 1,317 cases from the risk review group, and that will inform any future assurance that is required. There are a number of different outcomes from that group. They could assess, given the holistic nature of risk assessment and the fact that LSCMI is one small part of that, or not small, sorry, one part of that, then that's likely to inform any future assurances in terms of other old cases within the system. If they assess on that and they are confident that there has been no impact, then it may be that provides a high level of assurance. But that we will take our advice from that in terms of the experts. That's not something for me to sit here and say would be appropriate, because I'm not an expert in risk management, and we need to make sure that we take proper advice on that. And then we've got the wider review of open cases within the system. And that is very much working with the IT provider and the professionals and the risk management authority to identify what will provide that level of assurance and public confidence in those existing cases. I suspect it's not likely that every single case will be reviewed, because there are automatic built-in review points as an individual is being managed. So there are obviously, when a decision point is up, you would expect a professional to have a look at the LSCMI and make sure that it's assured and accurate. And thereafter, as I understand it from the professional social workers that I've spoken to, individuals are ordinarily reviewed on a 3-monthly basis. So within 3 months, I would like to think that a lot of these individuals on these open cases would have had a case reviewed.
Just finally, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, if any of those people who... the language being used is live public protection issues or known public protection issues. But can I ask, Cabinet Secretary, are you confident that no one has been released earlier than they shouldn't have been under normal circumstances? And if anyone has been released earlier than they normally would have been were it not for the IT glitch, that any of those people did at any point in the past pose a public protection issue or went on to reoffend or end up back in the system out with what would be normal reoffending rates, which we talked about earlier. So I guess we're looking for a little bit more comfort that those who were released did not go on to reoffend inadvertently.
I think on the one hand, given what Kat said about the further processes that we have to go through, it's right to wait for those processes before being absolutely definitive. But I think two things, if it's comfort that's been sought. One is if you go through 285 cases and not one single one gives you cause for public protection concerns in the views of the experts that have looked at, that's a good sign, a good indicator of where we're at, but it's not definitive and I'm not trying to pretend that it is. And the other thing to say, given some of the publicity that flowed from last week, is LSCMI, I think this was, it may have been in the briefing, I can't remember, maybe another briefing that I've seen, is almost like a general triaging tool, whereas over and above that, if somebody is a sexual offender or at high risk because of violence, of causing public, there are separate tools which deal with that. That's not just LSCMI may be involved, but it won't be the end. There'll be other things which deal with that, which I think should provide reassurance. But can I just add a couple of points, please, Kabir, because I know there wasn't time to take the opening statement, but I sought within that to address some of the questions which members quite rightly asked of me last week. So Paul McNeill had asked about, and I think Jamie Green made mention of it as well, the technical nature of the update, and I would hope that people will see, both from the briefing that's been provided and from what Kat said, how technical this is, although I did specifically ask for the briefing for members to be as in plain language as possible, because it is quite sometimes difficult to understand the different aspects of it. I should say I also had a question from Stephen Kerr, where I was asked about when it first came to light, and I said the 24th of January. Apparently the first person to see it was an individual in SPS on the 13th of January. I may have said that as well, but certainly I mentioned to Stephen Kerr the 24th. The 24th is when government officials became involved and started running tests in parallel with the system. And I was advised, as I said last week, on the Friday previously, and it came to Parliament. And I'll just say that in relation to being quick with that, there was a case down south where they wiped 400,000 prisoners, I think it was prisoners or offenders' records. There was no statement made to Parliament down there until after the event. I was very keen to make sure that we didn't do that and we came as soon as possible. But one consequence of that, just to get back to Jamie Green's question, is we don't all have all the answers. We are working this through just now. We're providing as much assurance as we can. I think it's pretty substantial assurance given the 285 live cases which we have that have not produced any cause for public concern. But I just wanted to make sure that the questions, there's probably one or two others that were asked last week, we have tried to deal with. If not in the briefing, I would have dealt with them in the opening statement, and hopefully that's given some reassurance as well.
Much. Apologies, I was just very, very aware of the time, hence going straight into questions, but I'm sure that members are certainly very well come back and ask our further questions. Is that you, Jamie?
I'm keen to let
Vincent I think we'll jump just move on. Thanks. Yeah. Katie, I'll hand over to you.
Thank you. Just picking up on the point about other systems, have you been able to work out yet exactly what the profile of the kind of cases we're talking about, and in particular, some of the more serious offences, for example, how many sexual offenders are involved? And in terms of the huge workload that's involved in reviewing the case, how have you prioritised, and have you been able to prioritise some of the cases that would cause the public most concern? And perhaps if you could maybe sort of outline in layperson's language the approach that you've taken.
Can I come in first on that? Because you raised a similar question last week, and as I say, I would have addressed that in the statement. I think what's here should provide some reassurance. So you'd asked about the kind of offences involved, particularly around sexual offences, and I was grateful for you raising that issue. But the LSCMI is not an offence-based system and doesn't record the type of offence. I've tried to explain it's a kind of generic system, a kind of triage system, which may seem strange, but it's entirely consistent with the risk assessment approach. And as we set out in the briefing paper, it's a general tool that looks at general factors, including potential offending. But part of the judgment applied relates to a different part of the assessment, to come on to your question, that looks at the nature of offending and provides structured consideration around nature. I know we've said this a number of times, it's important to get across that there are different elements to every risk assessment that takes place. That element of the system does not have a score. For example, individuals convicted of a sexual offence will have bespoke risk assessments carried out, likely focusing not just on general offending, but on risk of harm, which are particular to that type of offending. So there are other processes which cover that. And I think what we've done so far is to concentrate, you've asked about priority, the 285 live cases. So that's the priority we've taken so far. Sure. And now moving on.
I mean, and that's why I asked about other systems, whether you are able to use other systems that you have to pick out certain types of cases that perhaps may be of the greatest concern, and whether that has been incorporated into the work that's currently ongoing, so that perhaps some of the most serious offenders or the types of offences that would be likely to be the ones that people might be most concerned about were the cases that were looked at first. Are you able to do that with the systems that you have available to you?
So, I mean, I would make an assumption that the professionals within the system know the type of offending from the individual that they are managing. And that's why we're working with the professionals to identify what level of assurance and what type of review we do in terms of any other open cases within the system. So we will work with the professionals and the Risk Management Authority to identify what those priorities should be. And one of the messages that's been coming out from our social work colleagues is that they do want clarity in terms of what it is that we're asking them to do. So we will make sure that we provide such clarity.
So is it the case there for the serious sexual offenders or individuals that have been involved in serious violence would be the kinds of cases that professionals would be asked to look at first?
It certainly could be, but I think that the point that the Cabinet Secretary made is that looking at an index offence does not necessarily help you to understand the risk of an individual. You could have somebody on a relatively low tariff offence that creates a greater risk, and you could have the reverse. I've spent, previous to coming to government, 20 years as a procurator fiscal. And I remember one case that I prosecuted on indictment that on the face of it, if you'd looked at the index offence, could have looked, you know, as if there were five breaches of the peace, but it was clearly of a very sinister nature. That case in itself ended up being referred to the High Court for a detailed risk assessment from, you know, risk management accredited assessors for an order of lifelong restriction to be considered in that case. So it demonstrates that the index offence is not necessarily linked, but in terms of public concern, I understand that, and that assurance level that we can feed in where the professionals tell us that should be prioritised, then we can feed that in.
So you're asking professionals to look at their current and former caseloads and to take a judgment as to any individuals that they may have concerns about, and those cases would be prioritised?
Well, certainly we're working with the professionals. Yeah, we haven't asked them as yet. Because we're working with them to identify what the parameters are to make sure that we provide clarity on that.
So you haven't actually asked professionals to do that yet?
We had a meeting with them on Monday to try and work out what the parameters of this review should be, and then we take advice from the Risk Management Authority to make sure that they're content with what it is that we're proposing to do.
So the concern was first sort of brought to attention on the 13th of February, although I appreciate that the full extent of the problem might not have been, you know, apparent at that point. But as yet, we've not actually got to the point where cases are being looked at by those who deal with this work. Is that the case?
The priority has been on the 285, and that's what the professionals have been doing since we've identified the cases to them. They have been providing that assurance, and the last two cases were reviewed overnight, and the confirmation was provided this morning. So
as we're saying about the priority was the 285 live cases, which have now been completed. That's the priority we set for those involved. I should say it's the 13th of January first came to light, 24th of January further test done by government, and then leading up to 25th of February. But just to go back to the previous point, about the types of offences, that 285 would have been subject to the LSCMI, which is why we've
looked at those 25. But they, if they were, for those that were sexual offences or high-risk violent, they would have been subject to a different tool which manages them in terms of that high risk as well. So that's also there as reassurance. And what Kat's now talking about is how we go further and go back in time with these to make sure we're satisfied with the rest of the system as well.
And Cabinet Secretary, on the cases that have been looked at, have you asked for a breakdown on the kinds of offences that are involved in that cohort? Did you ask for that information?
I'll let Kat come in, but our priority was to make sure there was no issue of public protection in relation to that. And sometimes, as has been mentioned already, the index case for which somebody's first convicted doesn't give you the full information. But I don't know if you want to add to that, Kat.
I appreciate that point, that somebody may be a very dangerous individual, but they may not actually have been convicted of any serious offences. But many of that cohort would have had convictions. And did you ask for that information?
I don't recall that information was asked for in the initial. The initial reassurance was sought as soon as the issue was identified, and it was the priority was checking that there were no concerning or immediate public protection risks.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, I'm just watching the clock there. I just think it's probably very, very quickly, so Jamie.
What happened?
Apologies, I didn't realise you were waiting to come in.
Yeah, no, I'm taking
that. On you go.
Just
a supplementary really to follow on. Can I just check on a technical level? If someone has been released, they've basically been released, there's no recall to prison, for example. That's the first technical question. But the second is there anyone who's currently due for early release, given that it is an automatic process for some sentences rather than a assessment-based release, who will be eligible for early release but may have been incorrectly risk assessed? And if so, will there be a moratorium on their release, automatic early release, if there is the potential that they've been wrongly risk assessed by the IT system?
So I think you're right, Cameron. I think that what you're talking about is the release from prison. And that short-term prisoners and long-term prisoners. So if we start with long-term prisoners over 4 years, they're only released from a parole board decision, and that's contained within the briefing pack. And shorter-term prisoners under 4 years, they'll be released at the statutory point of their release. And I think it was highlighted this morning in terms of the statutory provisions around what they're obliged to take in terms of that through care support.
So they'll be released anyway, even if they've been wrongly assessed? Is that, that's kind of the crux of my question, just due to the nature of the policy.
Well, in relation to short prisoners, the release date will have been set as part of their sentencing in the first place. In relation to longer-term prisoners, it will be a decision for the parole board, and they will have all the different experts there to provide that risk assessment at that time. I should say, maybe it provides further reassurance to say that everybody's been made aware of this now, so all assessments currently being done have been looked at in light of this, and in any event, it will be overtaken very quickly by the three-month assessment which prisoners in that, or not just prisoners, but offenders in that situation will be subject to. So even if we had discovered something, this process is starting to bite, whereby this is taken into account with future assessments that have been done, if you follow me. So the original court sentence handed down by the court in relation to a short-term prisoner, and Kat will correct me if I'm wrong, as a former fiscal, is set by the court. So that we don't have the ability to change that.
Okay, thanks. Sorry, Fulton. Thank you.
Very much. Apologies again, Fulton. I'll bring you in, and then I'll bring in Rona.
No, thanks, convener. Apologies as well, because I wasn't sure whether when I indicated earlier, you took it as I wasn't wanting in, or I was, so it was also my fault. I mean, obviously, I would be really keen to come in. I'll draw members' attention to my register of interest. This is before I became an MSP in 2016. This is exactly what I'd done for my work. So the LSC CMI is a system I'm very, very well aware of, doing several, I was going to say a week, but more likely several a day. And I was on the initial training in 2012 when the system changed as well. So. And I think that it's a very, very good system for what it's worth as well. But I wonder, so I might be able to ask some helpful questions in terms of the LSMI to the Cabinet Secretary. You know, I know you've spoken a wee bit about this, but, you know, would you accept that it's not just the LSCMI that's used and that there's a whole range of risk assessment tools? So it's not as if, you know, perhaps to put members' minds at ease, you know, you wouldn't just do an LSCMI and say, oh, computer says yes, so that means that means this. You know, is that a point that has been made to you when you've been speaking to people?
Yeah, and I think last week during the statement, I read out the different categories of professionals that look at this, and as you'll know better than any of us, Mr. McGregor, there's a whole list of experts, that look at this, as well as the tool that's mentioned. And just to say that, in going back to Katie Clark's point, you know, have we asked for a breakdown in terms of the offences? No, we could do that and we'll look into that, but the simple fact is the individuals, the social workers and others, know exactly what the offences are. They're the ones that apply the professional judgment, and I think that's probably the most valuable part of the system, is the professional judgment of social workers and others that look at these things with other experts to help them. So it's a point I've made it a number of times, it seems to be lost sometimes, but it is very important to realise how this is a part of the system. And when you go into the other side of sexual and high-risk offending, there are other tools which are used for that in addition to LSCMI.
Yeah, and building on from then, is in terms of the cases that you have identified and have been working through, have all of them that have been subject to the professional override that you were talking about in the Chamber last week, and I'll come back to a wee bit about that, but have they all been cases where the risk has been lowered from what the LSCMI said, or not? Is that information you've got?
So in terms of the clinical override, is that what you're asking?
Yeah.
So I think the what we were able to confirm in those cases is that the risk level has changed in both directions.
Okay.
And clinical override had already been applied in a number of those cases, but not all of them.
Yeah, so that was actually the point I was hoping to make, that, you know, if the Cabinet Secretary wants to comment on the fact that the clinic override, which I felt last week in terms of some of the questions, and you can understand why that would be the case, you know, that it's been about the override bringing a risk down to what the LSCMI says, but actually it's as likely, if not more likely, that, you know, if the LSCMI is indicating a low risk, but actually professional judgment indicates higher risk, that you know, is a higher risk is actually put in, and is that a point that he accepts?
Yeah, I think I gave the example last week in relation to the issue that we have with the alcohol assessment, whereby it seemed more likely that what was being done is somebody progressing away from alcohol addiction that may not have been captured, the lower score that would have been justified might not have been captured, was the example I'd given. But the professional override, and I'm saying this as a layperson, I'm sure Kat will correct me, has now been applied again to 285 cases. That's what's now happened. Yeah. The experts involved have looked at this and come back and say there are no public protection issues from the 285 that they've looked at, and those are the live cases. What we now have to do, as has been urged by others, is to go back and look at previous cases before. But it's a pretty good indicator about the level. If 285 out of 285 come back and we have no issues, but that's what we now have to do. We accept that that's in the interests of public reassurance.
And just to add to that, one of the strengths on the literature of the LSCMI tool is that professional judgment and that override facility is available when you look at the literature around all the different risk assessment tools that are available.
Thank you for that. And in terms of the override function, which I agree with you, is a very important part of it, does the Cabinet Secretary and officials accept as well that when those are used or utilised, if you like, it's actually quite a robust process? So I think I would take the opportunity to say that, you know, I wouldn't want anybody thinking it'd be an individual social worker or another worker sitting somewhere doing an override, and then, you know, that would be it. It needs to go to several levels of management in most cases, and then the higher up management are going to have a higher level of experience as well, and also you've seen from seeing the forums a complete a narrative around the justification of that decision in either direction. So you know, would the Cabinet Secretary take the opportunity to join me in terms of offering that reassurance. That's
I think I was aware of some of that, but not aware, as you are, of the detail of that. And it does provide further reassurance. It's not the case that, as you say, something takes from one computer system and that drives the whole process. The professional judgment shouldn't be kind of rushed past. It's a really important, if not the most important part. But as you're saying, it's not just that professional. It seems to be then checked again by others as well to make sure there's nothing that should be questioned in relation to that. So it is a very robust system. Obviously, we regret, of course, the two issues that we've had with the IT system, and we have to learn from that, and we will learn from that. There'll be an ongoing process of going back with the providers to make sure that we try and cover this in future and make the risk assessment system as robust as we possibly can. It is robust, it has been. These two issues with the IT system have given us the concerns which we've addressed and come back to Parliament with. But we want to have the most robust system possible. And it's also probably worth saying that one feature of the Scottish justice system, which has more people on demand and more people in prison than many other systems, is we're not, or we are rather, or we could be accused of being risk averse, given that. So, but we have to have the proper system in there, and we should both be accountable for anything that hasn't worked as it should, and make sure that we get it remedied as quickly as possible. And that's what we're now currently trying to do.
And just one more very, very brief question. I hope I've been able to use my experience in this area to ask some helpful questions to the Cabinet Secretary that would maybe be able to reassure people out there. But on the other side of that, I'd also like to ask probably my most challenging question in that respect then, in terms of the override or the professional judgment question. It has obviously been an area where, even way back to the training, that has had question marks obviously over it in terms of people's feeling confident, and that's why it's got that level of a management experience and that around it. But given what's happened, it's very likely, and I've been spoken to previous colleagues, that people's confidence will have been impacted by this. What steps are the government likely to take to support people in the profession to bounce back from this and to feel confident and not, you know, end up having more work as they try and make these decisions? I mean, is it funding? Is it resource issues there as well?
Well, first of all, there obviously
will be a confidence issue now moving forward.
That latter point about funding, I did briefly touch on last week, and we have made it clear that we're willing to, of course, respond to any requests for financial support, which derived from needing more resources and more people to look at this. But on the question about rebuilding the confidence, I mean, I think there's a number of levels to that. One is the IT system itself, so that would be IT people that we've now engaged with, and we'll engage with others to make sure that that is right and as it should be. And beyond that is, I think, as a number of members have raised the issue about going back in time to previous now closed cases and making sure that it operated as it should have done, despite these IT issues in the past. And those two things, I think, should help to provide that confidence. We're also taking the opportunity to see if we can look for further improvements in the system as well, as you should do at any point. But this seems the right point to make sure that we do that as well.
Thanks.
Okay, thanks very much. I'll just bring Rona in.
I don't really have a question because so many questions, but just a very brief comment. You know, having listened to the evidence this morning, having read the briefing notes, I feel very reassured, and I feel my initial instinct that this is largely, these decisions are based on a whole series of professionals, and it's not so much about a computer. That's what I felt from the start, and you confirmed that, so I'm quite reassured. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Okay, I think just in the spirit of timekeeping, we'll bring things to a close. I apologise once again for my sloppy convenership this morning, forgetting to take you in and not allowing you, Cabinet Secretary, to make your statement. You are, of course, welcome to make any additional final comments at the moment or share information with the committee in due course. And on that note, I suppose I would, just on behalf of the committee, just ask for a reassurance that the ongoing review process that we've spoken at length about today is something that perhaps the committee will be kept updated on.
happy to give that assurance. It's an ongoing process, as you say, convener, so it may be worth more than one update as we go through the process, but we'll make sure the committee are informed.
Yeah, perfect. My thanks again to Cabinet Secretary and yourself, Ms Dalrymple, and I'll bring this part of the meeting to a close, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you.